to the Tennessee Arts Commission for their support of the work that we do. I also need to say some thanks to media sponsors, so thanks to Nashville Scene and to WPLN and to NowPlayingNashville.com for their support of the festival. I also want to say a big thank you to Nashville Public Television for supporting us. They're great roommates. And they have provided us with the equipment we need to live stream on HowlRound TV. Look, it's going to be up. So thanks to them. And of course, thank you would not be complete without thanking the most important person of all. She's the woman who had the vision for this project. She certainly has always believed that new works were an important part of making the American theater vital, and she puts her money where her heart is. So a big thank you to Martha Ingram for supporting the Ingram New Works. Tennessee Rep is about to turn 30 years old. We're celebrating that anniversary next year. It was founded the same year I was born. Anyway, in honor of that, we're launching a membership program. So I hope that you'll go to our website and take a look and see what the different levels of membership participation might be. I think we've got some interesting and cool things to do for us all to get to know each other a little better. So look online and see about that. And while you're there, you can, pop on over to the subscription page and buy a subscription if you haven't done that yet. We have a great season lined up next year. We hope that you will join us for that. We also have a big fundraising party in less than a week. Next Sunday, River Reprise is called. So if you're a big supporter of Tennessee Rep and you really love the actors that we have on stage, this is a big party at the end of the year that celebrates the end of the season. And all the actors who participate throughout the year are invited to join us. And there's dinner and entertainment. It's great fun. So if you want to join us for that, I hope you'll look up information about that back there on the table or also online. Okay, a quick overview of the Ingram New Works Project. It's got three parts. The first, a fellowship, a lab, and a festival. The fellowship is a fellowship that we offer to a playwright of national repute whose work we actually admire very much. It's someone that we are confident that will continue to make valuable contributions to the American theater, and we were very honored this year when our fellowship was accepted by the wonderful Pulitzer Prize-winning, Tony Award-winning playwright, Doug Wright. Nice. And he's here tonight. And then there's a lab, which is a season-long commitment for four playwrights who are accepted into the lab. They work on a play from its idea until what you'll see tonight. They come into the lab with just an inspiration for a play that they would like to write. And then we help them by providing whatever we can in terms of resources toward the writing of that play. They get together every month. We provide professional actors. And ultimately, we end up providing this opportunity here that I'll talk about in just a second. But before I do that, I want to recognize those four playwrights for their wonderful work here with us at Tennessee Rep. We've been very honored to have them with us. Not actually present tonight, but I think he's in the interwebs, is Jeremy Soney. So let's applaud for Jeremy. Being here. It really is exciting for us to be involved in this kind of work. We think it's important and invigorating, and I hope that you feel the same way, and clearly the fact that you're here means that it means something to you. So thank you for your support. Sit back and enjoy. Andrew Kramer, cut it out.
Cut It Out by Andrew Kramer. 1. Prologue. The bedroom of the Helmer house. Because it always begins in the bedroom. The silhouette of a large house appears before us, simple and reflective of a shape, a frame, a shadow, but we can't see any real detail, haze that makes us feel displaced. Then, an isolated light reveals Rebecca, standing in an evening gown. She looks older than she is. She married too soon, had children too young. The house and the isolated light shining down on her seem confining, restrictive. She sways, sort of dances, a simple but sexy tarantella-type movement. Faint, distorted music in a minor key is heard far off in the distance. So far off, we barely hear it. Also off in the distance, behind her in the dark, we can see another woman swaying with her, copying her dance. It's a shape, a frame, a shadow, but we can't see any real detail. Also, we see that there are a skew of medium-sized stone gargoyle statues scattered about. They seem to glow. It's unsettling.
Oh, Rusty. Oh, Mr. Helmer. Look at me. We need to have our annual review a little early, because we have some things we need to go over. But first, we need to turn these lights down. We need to turn these lights so far down they go out.
The soft light fades, and with it, the music. In the darkness, we hear the sounds of blankets moving, of Rebecca getting into bed. Then, a loud, harsh noise, a smack, a break.
Holy shit! Jesus Christ! Rusty, my face!
Her words, her cries, her pain echo into the dark. A harsh reverb filling the entire space, crashing against everything. 2. Muriel's house. Lights shift to Rebecca and Muriel, finishing a lavish dinner. Muriel's a woman attempting to be a perfect suburban housewife, and she's sort of good at it, but she's ceramic. And there are cracks. It's like her saturation levels have been toyed with. She holds a coffee mug with both hands tight, sipping from it often.
No, no, no. I'm serious, Beck. It was the strangest feeling, making dinner, following such an intense recipe. I don't do that, make dinner or follow such intense recipes. That's just something I don't do, you know. But I did, because, well, I wanted to. And so I intensely followed the recipe. I put the chicken into the oven, I set the timer, and then I went into the bathroom, and I stood in front of the mirror, and I told myself, meaning I literally looked into my own eyes in the bathroom mirror, and told myself with deep breaths and clenched fists, I said, Muriel, I said that. I said my name. I said, Muriel, it is never too late to discover new talents and passions. So I smiled at myself to gain confidence, to gain self-assurance. And I sort of winked, you know, like this, sexy. And I started to think of all the new talents and passions I wanted to discover. I thought about new gourmet cooking I wanted to do, the lavish meat dishes I would cook, all the books I would read, history and nonfiction and chick lit and romance. But as I continued to look deep into my own eyes, while I continued to elaborately plot future dinner plans and future book club selections, thinking of all the ways I would self-improve, you know, improve the self, I saw a toothpaste stain in the mirror. Right there, down in the corner, a smudge. Tom, he does that. He spits into the sink, and it splatters all over the mirror. And if I've talked to him about it once, I've talked to him about it 1,000 times. But I just hope the meal tasted okay.
Oh, seriously, Muriel, there's nothing to worry about. The meal was impressive.
Oh, good. Really?
Absolutely.
And the best part, I have leftovers you can take home.
Well, tomorrow's dinner already done. Check.
See, I'm
you
not
make my job far too easy.
I'm not the only one who benefits from my habit of pre-planning. Oh, Rebecca, it's so nice to have the entire quiet, empty, clean house all to myself. Thank you for taking Tom out of town again. I think I enjoy these little work trips more than he does.
Well, he's gone for 10 days, Muriel. In the UAE, that's not a little work trip, dear. And you really should know. Tom does great work. Really.
Maybe for you, Beck. Maybe for you. But enough of this poo-poo. Didn't you come over to enjoy some wine? Some vino, some two cups, and your cheeks are red? Huh? What do you say?
I say, hell yes. It's been an awful week.
I bought a great Moscato DSD just for you.
Rebecca gets up for the wine rack.
Oh, no, dear, not on the rack. I'll get it. Don't you know the rules of dessert wines? Whites need chilled, reds do not. It's in the fridge, silly.
How the hell do you keep track of these things?
Muriel gets the wine.
New talents and passions. It's never too late.
Well, then we will raise our glasses to new talents and passions.
Oh, no, none for me, dear. I'm fine with my coffee.
I've never known you to refuse wine.
I'm fine with coffee, Beck.
Are you sure?
I'm sure. Yes, you drink up.
She pours a glass of wine, hands it to Rebecca.
Delicious, thank you. It's the perfect preparation before one goes home to their asshole husband.
Stop that. How is Rusty?
Rusty?
Yeah, how is he?
Oh, I heard you. I was answering. Okay. Yeah. I think he's having an affair.
You what?
You heard me. I think he's having an affair, or maybe a few. I don't know.
A few? Like multiple women?
Well, I don't know for sure, but he hasn't touched me, and I don't even remember the last time we scheduled a night. I'm terrible with dates. Everything blends together, and so I may have sort of a general time frame, but not...
Wait. You guys set dates to have sex?
We have to.
Oh, my.
Come on, you and Tom don't schedule it?
Tom and I don't have sex anymore. Oh, don't be silly.
Well, maybe. Maybe if you set dates, you would.
Then maybe if you didn't, you would.
Maybe. Men are just transparent like that, though. You can sort of see their indiscretions on them.
Oh, yes, I know.
And unlike me, he hasn't aged a bit, so...
Oh, stop. You look great.
Well, it wouldn't be a problem for him to find someone else to have sex with. That's all.
I'm sorry, Beck.
We just never touch anymore. At all. I don't even remember the last time we kissed each other.
It's funny about that.
I just thought... Well, I do remember when it all started going downhill. I know exactly when, actually. Snap. It was right after... Yeah, let's not talk about this. Yeah?
Yeah.
Private information about your marriage should be just that.
Yeah, you're right. I'm going to clean up.
Yeah, Muriel stands and begins to clean the table.
Yeah, let me help.
Rebecca stands and begins to help clear the table.
I just wish so badly we could go back, you know? Do you ever find yourself wishing we could just go back?
Every second of every day.
Sitting in Rusty's... What the hell was that thing? A cheap little Mazda?
Mazda? No.
Oh, my God. You remember?
Of course I remember. It was an 87 Toyota Cressida.
That's right.
Generation 5 X70 series.
Oh, what was that terrible color?
Oh, shoot. Give me a minute.
It was ghostly gray.
No,
that's what I always called it. Ghostly gray. Rusty hated that. He said if this car was ghostly gray, then so were my eyes, because that's the reason he picked it. It reminds him of my eyes.
No. Sunset silver metallic clear coat. That was the color.
Sunset silver metallic clear coat! Oh, man. Those are the days. They were so
nice.
Best. Once upon a time. Right?
I remember how much Rusty loved that car.
I remember how much I loved that car. That was our escape zone. That was our world. If that backseat could talk. Oh, Rusty and I were having the best sex then. We were each other's toys. And all we did was play. Little dolls. That car was his pride and joy.
The Cressida and that damn guitar.
How do we go from loving someone so much to...
To what?
To being so deeply unhappy when you see them, you know nothing else.
Some days are golden, and some are, well, some days are rusty.
Maybe you should just be thankful that you have days with him at all.
I guess.
Ugh, change the subject. She drinks her wine. Muriel continues to nurse from her coffee mug.
You could leave.
What?
You could leave. Look at how successful you are. You certainly don't need him for financial security. And forgive me, but if you're not, you know.
Not what? Fucking?
You're not.
Are you serious? Muriel, come on.
People leave. They do. They're deeply unhappy. Walls go up. They don't know what to do. So they bust through the walls and they move on. Perfect freedom on both sides.
Oh, really?
Really. We read about it in book club. Seriously, like every third book. People just don't want to talk about it.
I can't do that.
Why?
What kind of person would that make me, Muriel?
Strong, liberated, free. Melanie May would say a feminist, based on our discussion of last week's riveting Virginia Dalloway.
Those aren't real words, Muriel. They're buzzwords. They're not real, practical words.
Well, I'm sorry you feel that way.
Yeah.
It really wasn't a lovely read.
I can't leave, and you know that.
But why?
Shit! Muriel, the kids!
The kids will be okay.
Have you met them? No, they won't. Ty spends all his time in the basement, scraping and sculpting, carving away at those damn statues. And then when he's finished, he puts them on display for everyone to see. You should look at our backyard, Muriel. There are these terrifying homemade gargoyle creature things everywhere. And Rusty just keeps putting them back there. We have so many around the house, I can't escape them. I see them in my sleep. And Shauna, who knows what's going on with that girl? She never smiles around me. I feel like she speaks another language. I can never understand anything she says. She's never home. She never asks for anything. She never needs anything. She's just this beautiful, independent woman living in my house that I know nothing about.
Trust me, they'd be okay.
Well.
Muriel drinks her coffee. Rebecca drinks her wine.
Oh, shit, how'd it get to be midnight already? We really need to do this more often. I am happy to serve as your taste tester for your new recipes.
Yes, yes, run on home. Sorry I've kept you out so late. Here's to hoping tonight wasn't a night of the aforementioned scheduled copulation.
That it was not.
Well, hurry home. Perhaps it could be, huh?
Thank you for the dinner, Muriel. And the leftovers. Once upon a time, right?
Once upon a time.
Lights shift. Three. That same night, but in the basement. The basement of the Helmer house. Shauna appears in a focused beam of light, a flashlight held directly under her face.
Once upon a time.
Another focused beam of light on Ty, who works with his tools and a slab of stone before him. He's working on another gargoyle. He pounds, scrapes, chisels. It becomes rhythmic, like a bass thump, like a beat, like music.
Once upon a time, a long time ago, before any of us were even breathing, the blue earth was populated by vicious packs of terrifying beasts that roamed free among the land. Huge, destructive creatures that couldn't be contained. There was nothing around to stop and challenge them. But then, the first human beings started appearing, and for the first time, these horrendous monsters were met with a challenge. While the beasts were able to continue most of their destruction, the humans soon took action. And one day, a young boy, decided it was time to fight back. He knew that if he didn't, the lives of his loved ones would soon be threatened. The boy, with all the strength and bravery he possessed, decided to battle one of the monsters. But not just any monster. The monster. The biggest, most destructive, most terrifying monster of them all. The two fought, and the boy clawed and crawled and hacked and carved at the beast, destroying every part of it, until only one thing remained intact. The monster's head, still alive, snarling and snapping and trying like mad to fight back. With his hands aching and bleeding, the boy looked down at the beast's head, and he grinned, out of accomplishment, out of pride. He knew this would save everyone he loved. This was it. But as he picked up the beast's head, he noticed something strange. Something in the beast's eyes. Tears. Big, shaky tears, like raindrops. They were tears of a deep fear. A deep fear of the unknown. And the boy couldn't stand to look at them. He took his hands, and he dug deep into the beast's eyes, and he ripped them out quick and violently so he wouldn't have to look at them anymore. And with his bloody and beaten hands, the boy took the beast's head and placed it upon a large rock, a boulder in the middle of an open field, put on display for all to see. The boy knew the beast wouldn't bother them ever again. And this, dear friends, is the first ancient use of a true gargoyle, the first beast ever to be put on display in such a way to ensure that the other monsters wouldn't attack ever again. Because of this, it is said that a little bit of the monster's soul, its being, its energy, finds its way into the very center of every single gargoyle made after it.
Lights flick on. Illusion dismantled. Instead of a spooky, atmospheric story, we just heard a school project. Shauna stands with a paper copy of the speech. Ty watches on the edge of his seat, so excited with the words.
Yes, yes, yes. It's brilliant. It's perfect.
Listen to me, Ty. Tybo, Tyra.
Don't call me that.
I'm seriously super into this idea, like, all for it. And I really love, promise, the theatrics of it. They're great. But I have no idea what the fuck that story even is about or what it's supposed to mean. And I just need, like, a basic informative speech to skate to an A.
No! Please, just do it. Everyone will love it.
No, everyone will be disengaged, like, you know, sleeping or high or both.
Oh my God, like Grace Camp.
Wait, you heard about that?
Yeah. She had, like, drugs in her locker.
Not just any drugs, heroin.
Heroin? I heard it was something else, something,
No, it was heroin. I totally knew she'd get caught. I totally called it.
Why would she even bring heroin to school?
Because she's an idiot, obviously, and you know, on heroin, so I don't imagine her, like, synapses were firing properly.
Actually, synapses refer to the nervous system's ability.
I just meant she was pretty messed up is all. And you know, Tyra...
Don't call me that.
And you know, Tybo, you shouldn't, like, always feel the need to be so smart. That makes you seem distant, like, spacey. Look at me. Super smart, but also super cool and down to earth and friends with everyone.
Shauna's cell phone rings. She checks it, but doesn't answer. It rings again.
You gonna get that?
Nah.
She silences the phone.
Late for a call.
Yeah, wrong number. But look, Ty, all I mean is you need friends and, like, to leave the basement sometime.
Ew. Stop talking like that. You sound like what I imagine Mom and Dad would sound like if they, like, actually talked to us.
Yeah, well, that's because I sort of care about you, so know that. But you do need to, like, shape up. You need to have goals. You need a plan. Everyone our age should have a plan.
Does this mean that you're going to stop pulling strings for me?
No, so don't worry your pretty little head over it. All your work is being turned in. Your teachers have been spoken to.
Thanks.
Don't mention it, because I will when I need something from you. So... thank you for writing this for me and directing the theatrical spectacular that it could have been, but I think I'm going to just give a simple, normal speech.
Boo!
But wait. If it wasn't heroin, what was it?
Huh?
Grace, you said you heard it was some other drug?
Yeah. It was on the news. They were saying that police are freaking out because they found a whole collection of drugs in Grace's locker. Some they couldn't identify. There were, like, little packs of powder stuffed between the pages of To Kill a Mockingbird and shit.
Aw, poor Atticus. But she was definitely on heroin. I mean, have you seen her arms? Little gnarly holes everywhere, like pincushions. All the boys think it's super sexy.
Then why did they send it out to have its chemical compounds tested or whatever?
What? Send it out, like, where?
Like, to the FDA.
The FDA. Bullshit.
Seriously.
Shit.
time.
What's gonna happen, you think?
No clue. But probably some, like, bad shit.
Well, cool. Thanks for your help on this.
Anytime.
How do you, like, decide what they're gonna look like?
They're all their own. All slightly different, totally unique from each other. They're already in the stone, you know? I just have to release them.
Ooh, I like that.
Yeah. They're protectors. That's why they're on cathedrals and other ancient architecture. They protected the foundations from, well, from rain, but also from, like, bad shit.
Make one for me. I'm gonna head upstairs to my lair. It's late.
Yeah, what time is it?
Shauna checks her phone. 12:12.
Wow, late.
Wow, late? 12:12, meaning it's officially tomorrow? Meaning it's officially our birthdays.
Oh, right. Cool.
Cool? That's it? Weirdo.
Why be excited? You know Mom won't remember. Again.
Maybe this year it'll be different. Well, on that rather depressing note, I'm outie. I want to get upstairs before Mom falls asleep on the couch again and I have to, like, ninja past her.
Hey, Shauna, wait. Before you go, you should add something else to your speech.
Oh, God.
No. It's good. It's really funny. Hysterical. It's about the London Building Act of 1724.
Yeah, I bet it's a real laugh riot.
No, seriously. Because of the Act of 1724, the use of downpipes were made compulsory on all new construction of gargoyles. You know, for support. But because heavy statues were breaking off, like falling off the building they were attached to and, like, crushing people. Like, they would be walking and this huge stone gargoyle would just, like, fall on them and, like, crush them, smash their faces, kill them. So they, like, passed the Act of 1724 to save people. It's, like, the absolute best catalyst for historical change ever.
That's fucked up. Yeah, I'll add that. Shauna's phone rings again. She checks it, then quickly silences it. Well, have fun with your rocks. Don't stay up too late.
I won't. Happy birthday, Shauna.
You too, Tyra. Ty continues to work. The light shift. 4. Later still, the backyard. It's dark. The sounds from an old acoustic guitar fill our ears. We see Rusty sitting, smoking. He has his old, once-loved guitar on his lap. He stops playing and takes a drag. In the yard around him, we see a slew of homemade gargoyles adorning the landscaping. Rebecca enters.
Oh, Rusty. Oh, Mr. Helmer, look at me.
She takes note of all the gargoyle statues around.
Jesus. Thanks, Rusty.
You should be more supportive of your son's craft, of his art.
Shit. You scared me. I didn't see you.
No? Jesus, thanks, Rusty. Sounds like a pretty standard greeting, Beck.
Yeah.
What were you mumbling when you walked up? Couldn't quite make it out, but I'm guessing you were outlining some massive misstep I made with a work project or detailing just one more thing of which I am deficient, right?
Please, don't start. Not tonight. And you don't have to tell me that
you're late?
I know. Sorry. Long day. I'm exhausted.
Don't apologize. Just be better. How was dinner with Muriel?
Don't say her name like that.
Like what?
Like you have shit in your mouth when you say it.
He smokes a drag. He plays a simple sound on the guitar.
Why did you dig out that old thing?
Oh, feeling nostalgic.
You can still play?
Not something I'll ever lose, no matter how much time passes.
He smokes a drag.
Are you smoking?
Yep.
Great, that is an expensive shirt, which will now reek of cigarette smoke.
Ah, this is a joint.
Oh, a joint. Perfect.
He exhales a cloud of smoke. It dances.
We are not 16 anymore, Rusty.
I know that well.
And what is that? Is that a new statue? I asked you not to put any more out here.
Yeah, well, I told Ty he could. And we placed them just so, with the landscaping in mind. I think they look really great.
I don't like our yard being crowded by these monster things, whatever they are, okay?
They're gargoyles, which are different from monsters, and if you ever talked to him, asked him about them, you'd know why he makes them.
Why? Why does he make them?
Because they protect us.
Protect us from what?
Bad shit, I guess.
Well, I don't think they're working.
Just do me a favor.
What?
Be careful with playing this role, will you? Because it's not a legitimate one.
What role is that, Rusty?
The depressed and distracted working woman juggling being a wife and mother, so ease up and cut her some slack? That role?
That's not a legitimate one? Well, then neither is yours.
And what role is that, please?
Total shitbag of a husband, but a decent father, so ease up and cut him some slack, that one.
Do you ever listen to yourself?
No. I don't. I never listen to myself because I am too busy listening to you and to the kids and to our clients and to Muriel and to everything else around. I never listen to myself.
Well, maybe that's the problem.
Maybe it is.
Rusty smokes a drag.
Russ, I'm really sorry about everything. This project is a bitch.
Don't get so stressed out. They're asshole clients.
Asshole clients that'll bring our company, so by extension, us, a lot of money.
We already have a lot of money.
So we don't need more? Do you want to continue to have a job? Because I can find another contractor just as capable as you. Not better, so just let me know.
I'll let you know.
Because I'm not blind. I'm not dumb. I can see your lack of, I don't know, what the word is, investment, maybe?
Yeah, I think that's an accurate word. This was never what I wanted to do, Beck.
I know that. But you can at least try.
I have been trying.
Then we just may disagree on what that word actually means. Not everyone can be a fucking rock star, Rusty.
Rusty stopped playing his guitar.
I'm going to bed.
Wait, really?
Don't act surprised. You know how this goes. Good night. And I don't think you should sleep on the couch again. That's not good for the kids to see.
Yeah? Well?
Well, nothing. I saw it happen with my mom, and it fucks you up, okay? We need to be more aware of what we're doing to the kids.
Rusty.
Jesus, what?
You look sexy today. Working. In your denim. In your boots. I liked being the horny boss overlooking her sexy employee. The sexy employee just happens to be my husband. How does your ass still look so good in a pair of jeans?
You're not my boss. We're partners. And if you want to be something, start with a good mother and a good wife. Good night.
Are we really this far gone?
What?
Are we this far gone, Rusty? How?
I can't answer that question right now.
I'll try. Because I just want to know, like, a fucking ballpark, okay? How far gone is this?
I have a difficult time ever seeing happiness for us.
Okay. So what then?
All we should be concerned with right now is saving the remains, the fragments, the appearance. We need to make it look like it's working, even if it's not.
He disappears into the house. Rebecca sits, alone. She looks at the stars. Lights shift. 5. Late night. The bedroom. We're in the darkness of the bedroom that Rebecca hasn't slept in for some time. We see Rusty asleep in bed. The sort of bed that obnoxious rich people have. You know, way too many pillows and thick, bulky comforters. Seriously, they're everywhere.
Oh, Rusty.
An isolated light reveals Rebecca standing in an evening gown.
Oh, Mr. Helmer.
She sways, sort of dances. A simple but sexy tarantella-type movement. Faint, distorted music in a minor key is heard far off in the distance. So far off, we barely hear it.
I saw the way you handled your tools and materials. I saw the way your hands, big, I might add, dominated them. And I like that. I like that a lot. But I want you to understand one thing moving forward, uh-huh? We're not partners. I'm your boss. You're my employee. I'm the architect. You're the contractor. I design. You build. Got it?
No answer from Sleeping Rusty.
Good. Now that you understand that, we need to have our annual review a little early. But first, we need to turn these lights down. We need to turn these lights so far down they go out.
The soft light fades, and with it the music. In the darkness, we hear the sounds of blankets moving, of Rebecca getting into bed. Then a loud, harsh noise, a smash, a break.
Holy shit! Jesus Christ! Rusty, my face!
Lights shift. 6. The next morning. Lights rise on a kitchen where Rusty is making breakfast. He's wearing his well-worn manly man contractor clothes. We can't really see this. They're obstructed by the frilly apron he wears. He actually looks real cute. He attempts to set the table, but doesn't know where to properly place any of the silverware. He tries the fork on the left, then the right, then on the plate. Nothing works. Finally, he just throws it all together in the center of the table with a shrug. Shauna enters.
Ha! Bullshit! You're not, like, actually cooking breakfast, are you?
Watch your mouth. Don't say bullshit.
What, because I'm, like, 10 again, right?
No, actually, as of today, you are officially 18. So, yes, I'm actually cooking for you and your brother to celebrate birthdays.
Aw. Mom working this early?
I believe so, yes.
Surprised you got any sleep. I heard you banging shit around all night.
Yeah, sorry, I tried to be quiet.
Well, mission failed. What were you even doing?
Just some reno in the bedroom, light stuff. Sorry about the noise. Hey, what's up with you? You look different. Are you smiling?
I am, in fact, smiling.
Why?
Well, when I woke up this rather delightful morning, I heard like the sounds of little birds chirping outside my window, like almost talking to me, you know, fairy tale style. And I felt this strange radiant sunbeam caressing my face.
Okay.
And so I rolled over in bed, smiling and hugging my blanket a bit tighter, you know, one of those mornings. And spotted something perched just so on my pillow, a birthday card with my name on it.
Imagine that.
Imagine that. And so I opened it, and I saw that both you and Mom had signed it. Your note was sweet, Dad, but, you know, Mom.
Glad you liked the card, babe.
Do you think I really look that much like her? Because that's what you wrote in my card. That I am absolutely her daughter, looking more and more like her every day.
It's true. Absolutely true. How many pancakes, babe?
None, thanks. Just some OJ.
It's breakfast. You gotta eat at least one. You go get Rock Boy.
Shauna moves like she's going to leave, but instead pours a glass of OJ. Her cell phone rings. She checks it and quickly silences it. Then,
Tyra, breakfast!
Don't call him that. It's mean.
Why would that be mean?
Calling him Tyra. It's like, you know, calling him a girl.
Yeah, that's why it's funny.
You're going to make him self-conscious.
About what?
Come on, you know. Isn't he already a little, you know.
A little weird? Is this because of his gargoyle statue thing?
Well, yeah, and a little, you know, I just mean, isn't he a little feminine?
Feminine? Oh, my God.
No, am I wrong?
Oh, my God, times two. Do you think Ty's gay?
I don't know. I mean, I'd obviously be totally cool with it if he was, you know.
Man, that's funny. That's rich. How did you pick up on something like that before I did?
I don't know. I just want to make sure it's not like a thing people say about him at school. He's not getting made fun of, right?
When he actually goes to school, you mean?
What?
Whoops, nip slip.
Ty enters. He's carrying a heavy, medium-sized homemade gargoyle statue. It's grotesque and beautiful and impressive. He sets it on the counter. Thud.
Morning, Dad. Morning, Shauna. Finished another one, Dad. Worked all night. Think there's room in the yard?
We'll make room, bub.
Awesome. Wait, are you cooking breakfast?
Are you skipping school?
Where's Mom? She wrote me a birthday card. Weird.
I know. Me too. So weird, right?
Don't change the subject. Are you skipping school?
I'm not, like, skipping school.
You're what?
Spending time with your boyfriend?
Shauna, shut it.
Wait, what? What is this? What's going on?
Why are you skipping?
Again, not skipping. Editing.
What are you doing, man? You can't be doing that.
I have sculpting to do here.
Well, it'll have to wait.
Shauna skips a lot, too.
Asshole.
What's going on with you two?
A lot.
Okay, kids. Let's be honest with each other.
Okay, kids. Let's be real with each other. Try that. It's more hip, and we're more apt to listen.
Okay, dork. Let's be real with each other.
Better.
Are you guys okay?
I am. I'm great. Tyra?
Don't call him that.
Okay, fine. Ty?
Yep, I'm good.
Are you sure? Because I care about you both. A lot. A whole shit ton, okay?
You may be worrying about this a bit too much, Dad.
Yeah, I mean, I think we're fine.
But if you're not fine, I need you to tell me. Because I know things are rough right now between your mother and I.
Yeah, I saw her sleep on the couch again.
Yeah, that's just because she says it's more comfortable than our bed. But look, just because we're working things out between us doesn't mean I love you guys any less. Huh?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Good. So I want you to look at me. Huh? What do I have on under this extremely sexy apron? Come on. What do you see?
Faded jeans.
Work boots.
A stained t-shirt.
Bingo. What else?
Calloused hands.
And sadly, not from playing sold-out rock shows.
You have lines right there by your mouth from frowning.
Yeah, man. I do. Because I'm exhausted all the time. And look, I don't want this to be you two. You hear me? This won't be you two.
Dad, look. We're totally like modern kids of the now or whatever. We're way better at dealing with shitty home lives than you think. We're maybe even better at dealing with them than you and Mom are.
True.
A bite. A drink.
Hurry up and eat your pancakes. We got birthdays to celebrate.
Lights shift. 7. A doctor's office. Sudden, light, harsh, sterile on Rebecca. Her face is wrapped in gauze. We can see only her eyes and mouth. Where her nose should be is a splatter of blood. Also, off in the distance, behind her in the dark, we can see another woman. It's a shape, a frame, a shadow, but we can't see any real detail. She addresses a doctor we never see.
Thank you so much for taking the time to see me today, doctor, to examine me, to fit me in, doctor. I know you must absolutely have other people to see today, so really, sincerely, I appreciate you taking the time to see me.
The doctor says something to her.
Excuse me? I need nasal reconstruction, you can see that?
The doctor says something to her.
Well, yes, of course, rhinoplasty, of course.
The doctor says something to her.
The break? Oh, what caused it? Do you really want to know? Are you sure you want to know? I should say a lot of things. A lot of things caused the break, and I'd show you the break, but I can't remove this gauze. I haven't been able to remove this gauze, as I fear blood would gush out all over and cover your office like the Red Sea, the blood Red Sea. Is that even a thing? No, of course that's not a thing. Well, maybe it is a thing in, like, what's that book called? What's that story called? The Bible? Yeah, the Bible. Maybe it is a thing in the Bible, but before you ask what caused the break, the blood, I'm curious about things. And I'm a very busy woman, and I don't have a lot of time to sit and chit-chat with you, to chat with you. I have a ton of work to do, and I don't want Rusty to fuck it up. But again, I'm curious about things. And my face, it, ow, something about the word and the way I say it, ow, oh, there again, hurts. So I won't say the letter I. The letter T, because I can't really say I, T, without it hurting. Ow! There it is again! Ow! Well, l'ange du silence, juste sous-relais. My son, he says that to me. He says that to me when we don't have anything to say to one another. L'ange du silence, juste sous-relais. The angel of silence just flew past, and that's been happening a lot. Things with wings just flying past right here in front of my eyes. They fly right past like that. They fly right past. They may be angels or demons or dragons or gargoyles because, well, you see, my son is involved in, how does one say, stonemasonry? Yes, stonemasonry. And it's weird for a boy his age to be a high school boy to be involved in, how does one say, stonemasonry? Yes, stonemasonry.
And he makes these things, these angels or demons or dragons or gargoyles, I can't really tell which, but he makes these things and they have wings and they have eyes and they look at you as though they'll fly right into your ribcage, puncture your lungs, find your heart, devour it ravenously before you even have a chance to feel it. They're terrifying. But he says he craves beauty. He says he craves the freeing of the being and the freeing from the soul, of from within the stone, which is a nice thought. It's a beautiful thought. It's really a very powerful thought, I guess. But back to my fucked up face. Rusty, my husband, he's a contractor. He's a good one. With a name like Rusty, he has to be good at something. And men as sexy as Rusty are usually assholes, but he makes no exception. Rusty's a contractor, and he builds walls. He builds strong walls, load-bearing walls, impenetrable walls, walls between us. So last night, in a rare moment of affection, in a strange moment of attraction to him, I wanted to have sex. I wanted to have sex with him. Because I'm a woman, doctor. I have needs, and I wanted to, well, I wanted to fuck him. I turned in bed, and the sheets were moving against my body, and I hit my face against something hard there in the bed. Smashed my face against something. I pulled the sheets away, and down the middle of our bed, there was a wall.
Rusty appears in the bedroom of the house. So does the wall in their bed. It's an actual wall, most likely aged brick, dividing the bed down the middle. Rusty begins to work, adding another layer of bricks to the wall in their bed. He's a pro.
Well made. Harsh, but with a crafted sort of beauty. And Rusty builds these strong walls between us, so I figured I'd come to you, doctor, because, well, quite frankly, I haven't felt like this in a long time, in a very long time. I feel something, doctor, for the first time in a very long time, and it's a little alarming. It's a little frightening. I feel like I'm riding on the wings of those angels or demons or dragons or gargoyles, and it's a little alarming. It's a little frightening. Oh, wow. Oh, wow. Oh, wow. Is this what it's like to feel?
Rusty finishes the new layer of bricks. He goes to clean up. He disappears.
It's like this wave, doctor. This wave, doctor, of newfound feeling. This wave, doctor. It just washed right through me the minute I felt my face crack. This newfound feeling into my body, up to my black eyes, through my shattered nose, and into my center.
Yes. You're probably right. I'm just emotionally raw right now. I'm sorry to unload it on you, really. Really? You'll be able to do it today? Oh, that's great. Yes, it'll all be okay after surgery. Yes, you're right, it'll all be okay after surgery.
Light shift. 8, the Helmer house. A bit later, that same morning, Shauna sits with notebooks and papers spread out before her. A calculator, spreadsheets. She's working. Her cell phone rings. Shauna checks the number.
Okay, look. I am going to kick your ass if you keep calling me. Yes, I've gotten your voicemails, and yes, I would have responded eventually. I just need a bit more time before I can get you what you need.
Ty enters, eyes fixated on a piece of paper he has in his hands. She doesn't see him.
Okay, good, because yes, we should talk about our little plan. Shut up, it'll be okay. I'll see you when I see you. Keep calm and tell those crazy bitches to shut up and get to reading their stupid books.
Who was that?
Holy sweet shit! Don't do that! Don't walk up on me!
Jeez, sorry.
Yeah, well, sorry? What if I had a knife or a gun? What if I got so scared that I killed you out of sheer fear? What then?
What the hell is your problem? Are you high?
What? No.
Are you sure?
Yes, I'm sure. Are you gay?
What? No.
Are you sure?
Yes, I'm sure.
Shauna is high. Ty is gay.
What are you doing?
Just, you know, some schoolwork and shit.
She notices the paper he has tightly clenched in his fist.
What's that?
The most important document I've ever read in my entire life. Ever. Have you seen it?
If I knew what it was.
I found it in the stack of mail from yesterday. This is it. This is it, Shauna.
Yo, Space Cadet. What is it?
The Holy Grail. Look, here. They're doing a massive gentrification of Krog Park and the neighborhood around it.
Oh, why? I always found Krog Park to be a seedy little gem. Big open field, beer cans, and used condoms sprinkled among the dying foliage.
Ew. It's exactly why they want to clean it up. Bye-bye, seedy little gem. The city has had enough complaints. There was a petition, and now they're going to clean it up. Local businesses donated a whole bunch of money to the cause. They're going to make it more safe. Get rid of all the drug dealers and hoodlums. Do people still say that? Hoodlums?
Prob.
Well, check it out. They want local artists to submit proposals. They're going to have this large stone display pedestal, and they want the centerpiece to be a locally created art piece. Shauna, this is it.
You think they're gonna pick one of your scary-ass gargoyle thingies?
What?
I mean, they're great. I mean, they're totally great, but, like, they're trying to clean up the park, you know?
Fuck you.
Whoa, calm down. I was just, like, spoon-feeding you some reality. You and I both know they're looking for, like, some lofty piece, all flowers and pretty birds and shit. Like, you know, inspirational.
You think?
Definitely. People want flowers and pretty birds and shit.
Well, maybe I can do something lofty and pretty.
Nah, that's not you. You gotta stay true to yourself, you know? Self-preservation, all that.
Yeah, maybe.
He crumbles up the paper.
Thank you for successfully destroying every dream I've ever had in my entire life.
Hey, Ty.
I'll be downstairs.
Hey, Ty.
What?
Do you trust me?
Well, I just crumbled up the notice, so...
No, not about that. In general. Like, I'm thinking big scale. Do you trust me?
I guess so. Why?
Because I just need you to trust me.
Light shift. 9, after the surgery. Rusty and Rebecca in a car. He's in the driver's seat, she's in the passenger's. Her nose is in a splint. Internal tubes and packing are inside her nose. There are bandages on the outside for structural support. She's loopy from the anesthesia, but in a childlike way, it's sort of charming.
I thank you for picking me up, but I'm not thankful. I'm Rebecca.
You're doped up, so sit back and be quiet and let me get us home safely.
That was a very quick procedure. Zip, zip, nip, tuck, break, join. It was very, very quick.
Oh, surprise.
I feel wonderful.
That's the anesthesia.
No. Well, yeah. I mean, I feel wonderful because I'm doped up. And not the dope you had, but the Mary Jane, but the doctor's dope. Oh, man. Rusty, I feel wonderful. Listen to my voice. Do you hear it? It's a nice change from the flatness of serious depression, isn't it?
And they say no talking.
They said limited talking.
So then limit it.
I am. I just feel something.
You'll come down in a few hours and then the real pain will begin, so...
You're not getting it, Rusty. I don't feel... I am changed. I feel like I knew... It's an ugly sound. Especially coming from you. Don't shush me. Why is there a wall in our bed?
Rebecca,
you couldn't be satisfied with simply dishing out emotional hurt? You had to bring in some of the physical?
We can't even begin to discuss the concept of emotional hurt. We don't have enough time in our lives to discuss that.
Why is there a wall in our bed?
Because if I make it right, which I will, you won't be able to see or hear anything through it. We can each have our own separate spaces, but still be in the same room. And in the same bed, sort of.
We have a guest room no one uses.
Yeah, but that's noticeable. The kids will notice if we're in separate rooms.
But they won't notice that there's a wall in our bed.
When's the last time either of them has stepped foot in our room? They don't. Ever. Besides, they won't even notice it with all those fucking pillows and shit you have on the bed. You didn't.
Fine, I'll take the guest room.
Rebecca, no, the kids. You can't keep sleeping on the couch.
Boy, your parents really messed you up, didn't they? Was it more mommy or more dad? Is that where the fidelity issues come from? Because I'm betting it was mom.
I'm done arguing with you.
Did you ever like me at all? Did you? Did you ever want me? Did you ever like me? Did you ever like having sex with me?
Rebecca.
Because I liked it with you. I liked it with you a lot. I liked your muscles. Your ass. I loved it. You made my body move. You made me sweat. You made me want.
Good.
Did I ever do that for you, Rusty? Rusty nail, rusty chain, rusty buildup. Did I ever do that for you, Rusty?
Of course you did. You know you did. Now please be quiet.
You really do have the perfect dick. It's literally perfect. You know that, right?
Thank you.
Well, it was. It was perfect. Before the... snap. What is it they call it? Technically, what is the medical term? A break, a sprain, a fracture, an infarction? What a word, infarction.
Stop.
Is that why you have so much resentment and hostility toward me? Because I snapped your dick?
I'm going to get out of the car and make you find your own way home. You don't stop talking right now.
Hey, you're the one that loved me being the wild little fuck doll, right? You loved throwing me around and really just giving it to me, didn't you? You wanted me to sit on it. You wanted me to spin on it. So don't you blame me for your penile fracture, whatever. Your cracked dick was not my fault.
Well, technically, it was, Rebecca. It absolutely was.
Uh-huh. So that is where it went wrong for us. That must be why you don't like me anymore, right?
Yeah, maybe. Maybe that's why.
It changed shape when it healed. Your dick, I mean. I think you lost an inch or two, or at least it feels that way. Now there's like this curve, this sort of hook, sort of bow, which actually feels better for me, quite honestly. And if you ever used it anymore. See, I didn't break it. I customized it.
Drugs will make you sick if you keep thinking and talking.
Do you sit playing your guitar with your leg up in the hole in your jeans, showing your beautiful skin underneath, giving her a little taste of you?
What in the world are you talking about now?
For the woman you're fucking that isn't me. You do that for her? You sit like that?
Shut up.
I am flying high right now, like flying, riding on the backs of the creatures in the sky. So just tell me, are you having an affair?
We've been through this. No, I am not.
Deny. You wouldn't tell me if you were.
Look, if you want to have this conversation, we can have it when you're not stoned out of your mind. All right, we can have this conversation then.
You told me happiness is no longer an option for us. And so I'm just trying to understand. What do we do to escape this unhappiness? Oh, shit, Rusty, don't you understand? I have fallen so deeply into this place, this land, the land of waking up to the dark blue before morning, and there's no light anywhere at all, but you still get up to get ready for work for the day.
Me too.
Are we home yet?
No. We haven't even left the parking lot.
Shit. Light shift.
10, the same afternoon, later. There's a quiet knock on the door. Muriel enters. She's carrying a plate of homemade donuts.
Knock, knock. Muriel's here. Anyone home?
Oh, shut the fuck up. Ty's home.
What? How can we?
He's in the basement. We're okay.
Are those donuts?
Yes. Yes, they are. First time I tried the recipe. They're delicious. Have one.
Are you fucking kidding me? Why would you bring donuts over during a...
Because I, unlike you, am good at planning. I consider every possible situation. It's a good cover. Donuts are a very good cover.
Oh, hey, Muriel. Long time no see. How are you?
Hey, babe. How are you? I brought over some donuts for you all, freshly made.
Oh, sweet.
See.
The sound of the front door opening and a loopy Rebecca causing a commotion.
Uh-oh. Showtime.
Guys, what the hell are you doing? Why aren't you at school?
More importantly,
Who is this bandaged monster you're bringing?
Bandaged monster, that's a good one.
What happened to her face?
Bandaged monster, an autobiography by Rebecca Helmer.
She decided she wanted a nose job.
What? Why did you have a nose job?
Why the hell aren't you two at school? Didn't we just talk?
Oh, come on, Rusty, shut up. Drop the stern dad role, yeah? So boring. Isn't it boring, kids? Well, I for one think it's boring. And I also think it's nice that we're all home together. Our main concern now should be the appearance, right, Rust?
Rebecca, stop talking. Stop moving your lips. She's pretty far gone, kids. I'm sorry.
Nice. Where do they have her on?
I won't ask again. Why aren't you in school?
I went today, Dad. Really, but we have half day. We got out early.
Ty, I wasn't kidding.
He said they got out early. Gosh, Rusty, geez, leave him alone. Come on, Ty. Necktie, bow tie, tie fighter. Come sit with your mother, Pat Pat, here on this couch, and I will tell you about what your father and I used to do on our early days. Meow. Rusty, that's Ty, right? Because I can't really see you with these black eyes.
I'll be downstairs. I have work to do.
No, stay here.
It's really, really important work.
They all just sort of scurry away from me, don't they?
Can you blame them?
Hey, guys, I don't mean to be rude, but we do, in fact, have a guest standing right here in front of you all without being greeted. So please use your manners and take notice and say hello.
Who is that? I can't really see.
It's me, Beck.
Who's me? I'm me. You're
Muriel, dear. I hope I'm not intruding. I'd absolutely hate to intrude.
Well, truth is, Muriel, you sort of are.
Muriel! Wait, Muriel? Why are you here, Muriel?
Well, I just stopped over, dear, to bring some treats for you all. Hopefully these will make up for the intrusion, huh?
She offers her plate of donuts in front of them like a ceasefire.
Take a moment and just smell the aroma.
I can't smell.
Guys, manners.
Thanks, Muriel. That was very nice of you.
Yes, well, I just wanted to drop by and say hello, drop off the donuts, check in on you all, maybe get an update on that development project in Dubai. Tom just doesn't tell me anything. And see how the kids are doing in school. I mean, holy heights. Will they ever stop growing?
Oh, my face.
How can I help, dear? I'd be happy to help in any way that I can. That's why I'm here.
Well, you can start at the very beginning. Rusty, ask Rusty what really happened to my nose.
Oh, there's a story. I just love a good story.
You want a good story? How about the Big O story?
Now, dear, that's not appropriate.
No, I didn't mean... I meant the Big O. You know, the big origin story.
No one calls it that, Beck.
Well, I do. I call it that. And I really should beat your ass, Muriel. For ever introducing me to him. To Rusty. To rust-covered Rusty. It's all your fault.
Thanks for the donuts, Muriel. I'll see you to the door.
Oh. Okay. I guess I'm leaving. Here, Shauna, please take these donuts. Don't gobble them up yourself now, or I'll just have to bring over more.
Thanks, Muriel. Very much appreciated.
Come on, Muriel. I'll walk you out.
No, it's fine, Dad. I'll see her out. Stay with Mom.
And when you're all healed, dear, stop on over. I'll cook us another delicious dinner.
Absolutely. I can't wait.
It was nice seeing you again.
Rusty.
What?
How awesome do you feel right now?
right this very second. Because I feel pretty fucking awesome.
The sound of the front door opening. Lights fade. End of act one.
that you're beginning to shut things down because of that. That's why you're ignoring me. It's not the distraction or some coincidence, so don't for a second blame it on that. But I need you to try, at least attempt to make this work all the way until that time. Got it?
Muriel, may I ask you a question? Just, you know, a simple little ditty. I said, may I ask you a question, Muriel?
What?
Are you the supplier? Or say, maybe the manufacturer? Did you fucking create a new and totally amazing opiate compound using a collection of common household medicines and cleaning solutions that gives you an unparalleled sense of escape euphoria without any sort of emotional or physical crash whatsoever? Huh? No? So, you're just a petty little buyer? You're just a petty little pathetic buyer I brought into the game because I saw an opportunity to use you?
Don't discredit my role in this.
You're a mule, nothing else.
I've expanded our business tenfold. All of my friends, all of the women in the neighborhood wouldn't have dared
Whoa, slow your roll, bitch. You think I wouldn't have been able to reach all you delusional housewives sitting around on Saturday mornings in your bulging yoga pants and tacky-ass Ugg boots discussing some shitty-ass book by what's-her-fuck Jody Picoult without your help?
I brought it to them. I did that, discreetly and successfully. And discussions have been so much more lively since. They want more. You need to cook more, which is why we need to postpone the stop date.
Look, Muriel, be certain of one thing. I run a tight-ass game, and if you no longer want to be a part of that game, I'll gladly knock your palm off the board. We're keeping our stop date, which is, in fact, rapidly approaching. Deal with it.
Your last batch wasn't even up to standard.
Oh, there's a standard now?
Yes. Tasted different. You need to improve the formula or something. I just know it didn't mix as well in the coffee. It didn't fully dissolve. It left a weird ring around the bottom of the mug. I'm not the only one who noticed the weakness of the last batch.
So you want stronger drugs?
Stop calling me that. But yes, the candy needs to be stronger.
I think the candy is fine, Muriel. Maybe you're building a tolerance, an addiction, which is why I'm keeping our stop date. I'll cook one more large batch, that's it. After that, I'm out.
No, you can't do that!
You knew from the start this was just a temporary thing, a temporary calm to your ills, a way to escape for a bit and make some quick cash. That's it. It was never a permanent thing.
Well, it could be. So don't get comfortable, Kingpin. Thanks to Grace Camp, we now have a new market to consider.
Did you sell to Grace?
No.
Then how'd she get our drugs? I've been more than diligent in keeping them out of the school.
If I had to guess, she swiped it from her mother's medicine cabinet. Flannery Kemp is one of our best customers. And Lord knows, Grace wouldn't have kept the discovery to herself. So who did she share with? One person? 10 people? 20 people? We're on the map now. We're a thing now. We can't stop now. You're reaching new markets.
That sort of expansive market was never one of my goals. I wanted to keep this shit limited to the neighborhood, limited to you stupid, lonely, pathetic housewives. You're unbelievably easy targets. So, I'll make one more batch, and that's it.
It has to be a big one.
It'll be a big one, and then that's it. And after that, you'll shut the fuck up about it, and we'll both move on from each other. Perfect freedom from both sides.
Shauna takes a donut from the plate and takes a bite.
Understand?
Muriel follows and takes a donut as well. She takes a bite.
Yes, I understand.
Good.
They stand together, eating donuts.
But we've got a problem.
What problem?
Mom's nose, aka she'll be in recovery, aka she'll be in recovery and she'll be at home, aka she'll be in recovery and she'll be at home and I won't be able to cook it the last big batch in my room.
Shit.
Yeah. And if what I saw of her behavior is any indication of what's in store for me this week, we're royally effed in the A.
At least she'll be home.
Yes, Muriel, that's the very issue.
I meant... Never mind.
You meant what?
I just meant maybe you'll actually have an opportunity to sit down and talk to her. Maybe you'll actually have time to be a daughter. Maybe she'll actually have time to be a mother.
Muriel, our boundaries were clearly outlined at the start. You're not to talk about my family. You know that.
You're right. I'm sorry.
You know, Muriel,
wish you had a son, and that he was my age, because I'd be friends with him, and then I'd fuck him and get pregnant with this baby and talk him into keeping it and convince him we'll be great parents together and that we're in love forever and that we're the perfect couple. But then one day I'd go behind his back without telling him and get an abortion just to make him upset so I could rip his heart right out of his chest and chew on it and then puke the mangled little pieces of his destroyed heart back up onto your stupid fucking face. That's what I wish.
Light shift. 12, the next day. Rebecca stands in the bedroom, looking at herself in the mirror. Her face still wrapped, she looks at herself from various angles, feels the wrapping, applies pressure at the new nose. Behind her on the bed, we see that Rusty's brick wall has grown taller. Rusty enters, panicked.
Beck, what the hell? My phone hasn't stopped going off. It's 11:30, you missed two morning meetings.
Oh,
Rebecca, you missed two meetings.
I don't think I'm going to make it in today.
You're deciding this now?
No, I decided earlier. It just slipped my mind to tell you. I'm definitely not going to make it in today.
So?
So you can deal with it.
Are you feeling okay?
I feel great. Really wonderful, actually.
I said the anesthesia should have worn off by now.
Oh, it has. I've just been thinking about what you said, and I think you're right. I'm not your boss. We're partners.
Oh. Okay, really?
Mm-hmm. You should be able to handle things, right?
You're serious?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Good?
Yes. Good.
I gotta head out. I am now late for meetings I didn't know I was attending. You'll see, Beck. I'm capable of handling this.
Hey, Rusty. What do you think about my eyes?
Huh?
My eyes. What do you think about my eyes? Do you think I should have something done with my eyes?
Something like what?
I don't know. Just something. A change.
Your eyes are fine. I like them how they are.
Really?
Yeah. They're the color of the Cressida.
Huh.
Remember?
Yeah. Ghostly gray.
Sunset silver metallic clear coat.
Right.
I really gotta go. See you later. And I mean it. I'm more than capable, Beck.
Okay. We'll see. Go. Good luck.
Thanks.
Light shift. 13, the basement. Ty, where he usually is, in the basement. He's wrapping his hands in gauze. Somewhere nearby but partially hidden is a large something under a drop cloth. Shauna enters.
Tyba?
Sean?
Holy shit, what's wrong with your hands?
Nothing, they're fine.
They're gnarly. We may see some blood, broken skin, sores.
No, they're not fine. They're disgusting. What happened?
Been working really hard, that's all.
You need to watch it, Ty. This looks serious.
I said they're fine. What did you need? Shauna, what did you need?
I wanted to run something by you to get your thoughts, and considering the tragic state of your hands, it may be a really perfect timing. And you need to, like, not freak out. Cool?
What do you need?
Oh, you know, just a small favor, just like a tiny favor, just to, use the basement for a couple of days.
Use the basement how?
I need to, so I have this school project I'm working on, and I need space and, like, privacy, so I think this would really be ideal, and you'd never even know I was here, and yeah.
What sort of project? Do you need help?
Like, you'd be able to help with those injured tools? I'll be okay. But you can't be down here. I need you to, like, do something else for a few days. Let your hands heal.
What? Absolutely not.
Please, Ty. Please, please, please. I'll pay you a lot.
She notices the drop cloth.
Whoa, holy shit. What is that?
It's nothing.
Bullshit, nothing? What is that?
Please, stop. It's nothing. It's not ready yet.
So it is something?
Yes. It's the reason you can't use the basement. It's my entry for the Krog Park Art Contest. I decided against your advice, and I'm going to enter. But it's not ready yet.
so. I want to see what you're destroying your hands over.
Since when have you cared so much?
Someone has to, right? It's like, okay. Do you remember when we were turned 12 and I really wanted to get my ears pierced, so Mom took me to have it done and it hurt like a bitch, but I was super stoic and proud of my new earrings. The pain didn't even matter.
Yeah?
Well, I'll never forget that day because I remember going over to Erin's to show her my new earrings and her being like all horrified and shit. She was like so freaked out that Mom even let me do it because apparently Erin's mom told her she wasn't allowed to get hers pierced because that's what sluts did.
What does that have to do with anything?
It's just nice to know someone cares about you. So like in this case, I'm Erin's mom and you're Erin. And I care about you enough to, like, forbid you from getting your ears pierced and becoming a slut. So, can I please see what's under the cloth? I won't say a single word. Promise, for real.
Okay. You can sneak a peek, but it's not up for critiques yet. Got it?
Got it.
Ty goes to the thing under the drop cloth and pushes it over to Shauna. It's on a rickety work stamp with rollers. It's massive.
But be careful. There's a lot of weight on the pedestal.
Ty and Shauna lift up the cloth, but only a bit. We still can't see anything. Ty does, and he looks on proud. Shauna does, too.
Holy shit. Ty, what the fuck is that?
Shauna, wait.
Lights shift. 14, the next morning. Rusty at work in the office of he and Rebecca's architectural firm. It's a sleek, modern, well-designed office that he clashes against. He's still wearing his contractor clothes, a worker parading as a boss. The office phone rings.
Is this my 1:30? Oh, no, I can't see anyone right now without an appointment. What? Jesus. Okay, I'll make it quick.
There's a knock on his office door.
Knock, knock. Muriel's here. Anyone home?
She enters, but stays near the door. She's holding a coffee mug, which she sips for courage throughout.
Muriel. Oh.
Oh? I expected a better greeting.
I can't really see you right now, Muriel. I have a meeting soon. A meeting I'll need to be alone in this office for.
I wanted to check in with you about the Dubai project. Get an update. Tom didn't have much to say about it.
What are you here for, Muriel?
Do I have to have a specific reason to want to come and see you, Russ?
Don't call me that, and yes, you do. I need you to leave if you don't have...
I just thought you'd want to see me after I showed up at your house like that.
She locks the door from the inside and saunters over to him.
How are things at home?
It's none of your business.
Oh. None of my business.
Muriel.
Oh, cut the shit, Rusty. Are we going to do this or not?
Did you become so sure of yourself?
Oh, it's the little things, you know. I've been discovering myself, new talents and passions. I found a great new coffee. Strong taste, strong effects. It's like time travel, really. Wakes me right up, makes me feel things.
She downs the rest of her drink.
You have to leave this office, Muriel, right now. No one can see you here.
Who will see us? Rebecca's at home, right? Healing. She's at home. Healing, Rusty. I spoke with her this morning just to check in. It's so rare to see her take a day off, isn't it?
Muriel, I think we should talk about some things about us, about this. We should really do this anymore.
Do what?
Eat sugar.
Why is that?
Rebecca and I are gonna, we're trying to work things out.
Oh, you are? You were saying?
It turns hot.
night shift. 15, later that day. Rebecca stands in front of a mirror looking at herself. Her face is wrapped in more gauze than before. Shauna enters. She's carrying two large, overly packed bags.
Hey, Mom?
Yeah?
Oh, are you okay? You look pale. What happened?
What happened to you? I thought you were healing nicely.
I was healing more than nicely. I was healing great, so I went back for another small procedure. Well, three procedures, but they were all done at the same time. So convenient.
Whoa, really?
Yeah. Come here. Look, here. See this area of my eye?
Yeah, why is it so red?
I had eyelash transplants.
What does that even mean?
It's a safe and effective way to restore living and growing lashes to your eyelid.
Really? Well, what else did you have done?
You'll see them a bit more clearly in a few hours. The doctor said it was normal for them to be a bit cloudy after surgery.
Like surgery?
Uh-huh. Look into my eyes. My eyes aren't ghostly gray anymore. Now, they're lavender slate. They're artificial irises.
Why didn't you just get colored contacts? They've had those now for like 20 years.
Artificial irises are permanent and with a custom-made color. No one in the world but me will have this exact eye color.
Cool, I guess. But hey,
the artificial iris is a thin but very flexible silicone that's folded and inserted into the eye through a surgical precision incision. About 3 millimeters in length.
Holy shit.
No, it's fine. The procedure was safe and painless. It only took about 15 minutes in each eye. It's just so convenient. I love the changes. I really do.
But you can't even see what they'll look like right now with all that swelling.
But I can feel them. I can feel them. And I can tell they're beautiful.
Okay. But listen, the real reason I came to talk to you before I was distracted by your seemingly entire reconstructed face is to say that I'm going to be staying over Erin's place for a few days. Is that cool? Her, like, little dog died, and we both love that little bitch, so we're both, like, pretty shaken up about it. So I'm going to stay with her and, like, comfort her. I'm really good at that, and she, like, requested my presence.
Oh, yeah, of course. That's totally fine, babe. I'm sorry you're upset about it.
What did you just call me?
Babe? Am I allowed to call you that?
Yeah, okay, it's cool, I guess. Mm-hmm.
Good. Do you think it'll look nice? My face?
I'm sure it will when the swelling goes down.
Me too. Do you want to grab lunch before you head over to Erin's? I could drop you off after.
No, I'm okay. But thanks.
Okay, that's fine.
But, hey, Mom.
Hmm? Yeah?
What's up with all that?
What do you mean?
You're gonna look different.
Exactly.
But I thought you said that I look more and more... Never mind. I think it'll look nice.
Me too.
Light shift. 16. Later still, at the office, Rusty and Muriel post-coital getting dressed.
Wow. Glad you've taken up new passions and talents or whatever.
Yeah?
Yeah. You were great. Thanks. Keep drinking that new coffee.
As long as it's available. I love the woman it turns me into.
Good. Me too.
Really?
I just said it, didn't I?
You love the woman it turns me into?
Ah. I didn't,
No, I'm sorry. I didn't mean, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
They continue dressing.
I don't want to... Russ, you know, I didn't mean that I wanted...
Wanted what?
I didn't mean to bring that word into it.
Good. Because you know this is just...
Just what?
I don't know.
Can you tell me what this is exactly?
thought the rules were clearly outlined from the start. You know? It's a temporary thing. Temporary calm to our ills. Way to escape for a bit. Have some quick fun. No?
I just encourage you to consider the way things develop, Russ. Natural progression, you know. They begin as something and then they turn into something else, right?
Not all things.
Okay.
I'm not even a man that you want to... Look, it's just a way for both of us to have one thing, our lives away from each other, and something else, a life on the side. That's like a basic human want, right? And we figured out a way to make that happen, and that's nice. There's no reason things should ever overlap or interfere or interrupt the other, right?
You know, I actually struggle with that.
With what?
That delineation, that sort of separation.
Well, I'm sorry about that, Muriel, but that's not ever going to change.
Don't you?
What?
Struggle with juggling both things.
I try to make them both work.
Okay.
They're dressed. Rusty tucks in his shirt.
You should go.
Yeah. Rusty, I should.
I don't even see why you and Rebecca even want me. Not something to want, really.
Why would you say that?
Because you've both known me long enough to see what I've become.
And what do you think you've become?
I don't know. Not myself. My dick doesn't even work like it used to.
Stop. You really have a perfect dick. You know that, right?
Look, I gotta get back to work. I have some shit to do. Ty's expecting me to make him a new pedestal for his statues. I should get on it.
How is Ty? How are the kids?
I gotta get back to work, Muriel.
Rusty, here. Just tell me now. Should I abandon all hope of this ever turning into something more than afternoon meetups? Because I should know.
I'm working through some things, Muriel, so I don't know. But you should know that I love Rebecca very much. Even if that's not always clear to you, I do. I love her a lot.
Fair enough.
Gotta get back to work. You should fix your hair, huh? Looks like you've just been fucked over an office desk. People be suspicious.
Light shift. 17. Later that evening, the backyard. Rebecca is there sitting with Rusty's guitar. She's smoking a joint. Her face is wrapped in gauze, almost completely covered. Faint from the house, we can hear the sounds of Ty aggressively at work in the basement.
Jesus, Beck.
Hmm?
Your face. How can you even see?
Oh, I can see. It looks worse than it is.
It's hard to take you seriously. You look like a mummy.
I look like a cocoon. It's going to look great. I had a few more procedures, just some cosmetic stuff.
Is that healthy?
It's totally fine. The doctor says I have a very hardy system. He said I'm handling this incredibly well, both emotionally and physically. Isn't that great?
You say so.
I do. I do say so. Rebecca takes a large drag off her joint. She strums the guitar.
Are you smoking?
Yeah, I finished off your bag.
Can I have a hit of that?
I don't think you should. You have work tomorrow.
Yeah, I do. It's been interesting.
Harder than you thought?
Maybe a bit.
Yeah, maybe a bit.
I'm handling it well.
If you say so.
I do. I do say so. Miss being home so much with the kids. But you're here now, right? You connecting with them at all?
I will.
Good. Because they shouldn't be punished for our shit.
Yeah. Rebecca hands him the joint. He takes a long drag. She strums the guitar.
That's good.
Oh, shut up. I'm trying.
You're not holding it right. Adjust your hands.
Where?
Here.
Holding the joint in his mouth, he moves so that he is behind her.
There. Like this. Hold these fingers down when you stroke the neck.
It doesn't sound like they hope, but it was an attempt.
I don't have the fingers for it.
You show me. With yours. He sits, his leg up, a hole in his jeans shows us a patch of his beautiful skin. He plays a lovely sound.
What is that? It's beautiful.
It's just me playing.
You play something else? A quick, lovely sound.
Here. You try.
No,
one more time.
I just want to sit here and listen.
Sure.
Good.
Rusty continues to play his lovely music.
By the way, I think you should stop spending time with Muriel.
Why's that?
I don't know. I got to talking with Tom today. At the office?
Oh, yeah. How is he? What do you have to say?
I just think you should stop hanging out with her. She may be a little jealous of you or whatever.
What does she have to be jealous of?
I don't know, but she just seems desperate. And desperate people can be dangerous, you know?
Shh. Just keep playing.
Shh. Such an ugly sound, especially from you. Don't shush me.
Just keep playing. I just want to sit here and listen.
Rusty continues to play his lovely music. Rebecca sits, looking at her hands. Lights shift. 18. Later that night, the basement. Ty is alone. He's not working, but instead has hydrogen peroxide, neosporin, and a box of heavy-duty bandages in front of him. His hands are bloody and beaten from working so hard. He begins to dress his wounds. Once he has them wrapped, he gets up and goes over to his massive statue, again covered in the drop cloth. He puts on a pair of heavy gloves. He goes to remove the drop cloth. Rusty enters. He's carrying a wooden box, a pedestal for a statue.
Hey, Tybo, you're down here, right?
Yeah, what's up?
Seeing the massive statue.
Whoa, dude, stepping up your game, aren't you?
I hope. It's for that thing, that Krog Park cleanup thing. I really want to win.
Nice. What is it?
It's just, you know, something.
Well, I made you this.
He sets the wooden box down.
Well, I didn't know your statue was going to be so big, so this may be an inadequate pedestal.
It's fine. I didn't know either. Think you can make me a bigger one? The one I have it on now is pretty unstable.
Sure, Bill, no problem. Give me a couple days.
Cool.
Can I see it?
Not yet.
That's cool.
I'm trying something a bit new.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, Shauna said no one wants my, like, scary gargoyle statues, so I'm going to try something new, a bit more personal.
Well, that's cool. Do what you want, right? Sometimes I think that's the most important thing in this world. You only have one life, right? So why not do what you want?
Seems sort of selfish.
Yeah? Well, selfishness is a little underrated, I think.
Maybe. Remember how I told you that gargoyles protect us from bad shit?
Yeah.
Well, with my new one, I'm making it to... well, I don't want it to sound stupid.
It won't, tell me.
I'm making it to, like, protect us, the family.
Yeah?
Yeah. I think we need it.
You know I'm proud of you, right? All this, I'm very proud of you, bub. I mean, you're a total weirdo, but you're my weirdo.
Really?
Absolutely. Your work is pretty incredible, man. You know, other guys can say, oh, my son scored 3 touchdowns, or my son's playing a rock show tonight, he's pretty good, you should come, or hey, did you see the girl my son knocked up, she's beautiful. But me, I can say, yeah, well, my son took this ugly-ass, boring-looking rock and carved it into that beautiful statue in my backyard. I think that's pretty fucking cool.
Yeah, me too. Plus, Dad, you know that, like, you know that I won't ever, like, never, ever, knock up a beautiful girl, right?
Huh?
to say it.
Yeah, but... Dude.
And that's okay. Thanks. But hey, Dad?
Yeah?
Is there a difference between beautiful and perfect? Because I thought I was making something perfect. But now I'm not really sure.
Why is that?
I don't know, really, but... But what I do know is that I'm making something beautiful.
I know you are. Sure, I can't see it.
I mean, I guess you can. Can you help me wheel it over? Yeah. It's tough with my hands. They're really sore. It's pretty heavy.
Of course, yeah.
They push the massive statue into the light. Rusty stands back. Kai uncovers it. He has uncovered a large, deeply grotesque and disturbing statue unlike anything he's ever made before or that we've ever seen. There are four figures with tortured bodies, harsh, chiseled features with faces that look inhuman. The four bodies are wrapped around each other into a tight knot, limbs and expressions gnarled into each other. Lights fade. 19, the next day. Ty is with his massive creation, now uncovered. He gets out his smartphone and dials a number. Shauna appears, answering hers.
Hey, Ty, what do you want?
You didn't come home last night.
I know.
Where are you?
I thought I told you. I'm staying at Aaron's place for a few days.
Aaron? You hate Aaron.
Yeah, well, her dog died and I gotta be with her. I'll talk to you soon, Tybo.
Please come home. I'll show you the full statue. You just saw a part of it. You just got a peek of it.
I can't do that.
Why not?
I didn't like what I saw.
I know. I could tell. I know my statue made you uncomfortable, but come home. Come home and we can talk about it if you want.
It's super fucked up. I didn't like the way that thing made me feel. It's, like, super disturbing.
It's not supposed to be disturbing, and it's not supposed to be perfect. It's supposed to be beautiful. It's going to save us, Shauna. It's going to protect us. It's like if I scrape and chisel and carve hard enough, I'll get to that spot where the spirit is, and everything will fall into place exactly right.
Okay.
I can't help it if you felt its power. Dad saw it, and he liked it.
Okay, Ty. I gotta go.
Do you trust me, Shauna? Because I need you to trust me.
She hangs up. So does Ty. Slowly it's revealed. She's standing with Muriel. They're in her house. And Shauna still carries the large packed bags. Shauna and Muriel in the guest room of Muriel's house.
It was a good decision. Thank you for suggesting I stay here.
We don't have another option, do we?
No, we don't. But be careful and let me handle all this stuff. I don't want you to fuck anything up.
If we try hard enough, maybe spending this time together will be nice.
Yeah, maybe. Can I use this desk?
Of course.
And this bed?
Of course.
Good. We need to really focus on manufacturing this last batch.
The linens on the bed are clean.
Thank you.
And there are fresh towels in the closet.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Shauna moves over to her bags, opens them.
That's all you need? You can fit everything you need into a few overnight bags?
That's it. The drug and the manufacturing process share the same defining traits. Discreet and portable.
Good.
Shauna continues going through her bags.
Muriel.
Yes?
Why didn't you and Tom have any children?
It's a big question, Shauna.
You just seem like the type of woman who would want children.
Tom said that two lovers become a different kind of relative when they have children, and he didn't want that for us. Well, I found out very early in my life that I'm unable to conceive.
Wow.
Yeah.
Sorry. Well, I'm gonna start cooking this if you wanna watch.
No. I don't think I'd like to, you know, see that. Let me know if you need anything. I'll be downstairs. Your mother's coming over for a late lunch, so you'll need to be quiet up here, yeah?
Yeah. You won't even know I'm here.
Okay.
Muriel, wait. What did my mom and dad used to be like?
What do you mean?
before they became the ugly, tangled mess that they are now.
We're not going to talk about your family. The rules were outlined from the start.
Oh, no. That rule is only in effect when you bring them up. I'm allowed to bring them up. And you're the only one that knows what they used to be like.
We all have changed a lot. If you want to know, you'll have to ask them.
No, I'm asking you. Muriel, please.
It's all pretty obvious to me, if you want the honest truth. I've seen things change in your parents the same way I've seen things change between Tom and I. He came to me a few weeks ago while I was in the kitchen attempting to make Grandma Opal's apple pie. Not my Grandma Opal, I don't have one. That's just what the recipe was called. It was supposed to be the best damn pie you'd ever had. And Tom came to me while I was in the kitchen, and he came up behind me and looked over my shoulder to see what I was doing. And he dipped his finger into the bowl, and he tasted the sweet glaze. Half a cup of white sugar, half a cup of brown sugar, half a cup of unsalted butter, a teaspoon of maple syrup, which was a nice touch, and 8 peeled Granny Smith apples. Turned around and smiled at him, and I thought, maybe somewhere inside I even hoped that he would kiss me, take me, right there in the kitchen, lifting my body up so I could sit on the counter with him standing in front of me. But he didn't do that. No, he had this look in his eyes like he'd seen something for the first time. Revelation. The skin on his face rested on his bones in such a way that I could tell. This is it, I thought. This is it, and this is over. We are over. But it's okay, because we'll settle into that routine of domesticity and act like everything is perfectly fine.
But, Muriel, I asked you about my parents.
Yes, you did. Look, Shauna, this is what it is. There are two types of people in this world. People who choose a life, who select it, who weather it, who stay to finish it out. And there are people who are given a life, who fight it, who break it, who leave it behind. And I think your father is quite unhappy that he was given a life. And he's going to leave.
Do you think that's true?
I do. Your mother and father never wanted children. They didn't even want to get married. They were young and dumb, and all they wanted to do was laugh and smile and get naked with each other at every opportunity they could.
Ew.
That's what happens with total infatuation. But they were children. We were children. Your father was going to become famous, a filthy, sexy rock star playing sold-out shows in every city in America, and your mother was going to go with him, join him on the road. They had it all figured out. Sweaty, sexy rocker and his plaything doll of a wife. But things derailed. They were both given a life, and now they're fighting it. They're breaking it, and somebody's going to leave.
Muriel?
Yes, dear.
You don't know shit.
Well, you asked.
Lights shift. 21. Later that day, at Muriel's house downstairs, Muriel stands, coffee mug in hand. Also, though, there are 3 other coffee mugs in front of her. When she finishes the one in her hand, she picks up another and finishes it in one long gulp. The doorbell rings. Coming back! Hold on! She goes to answer the door, but stops. She hurries back over to the second and finishes it in one long gulp. The doorbell rings again. Coming! She goes to answer the door, but stops. She hurries back over to the third coffee mug and begins to chug it down. Rebecca enters, mid-gulp. She's covered in more gauze than before. Other than her mouth and eyes, we can't really see her face. Also, there is gauze wrapping on her fingers and hands. It looks funny.
Everything okay in here, Muriel?
So sorry, Beck. I just
wanted... Well, I've been at the door for a bit. Jesus Christ. What happened to you? I've just had some work done, that's all.
Wow.
Yeah, new talents and passions, right?
You mean new passions and addictions, right?
Excuse me?
Huh? What?
What did you just say?
Nothing. Just kidding. Have a laugh.
Are you okay?
No, I'm good. From upstairs, there's a loud noise, a thud.
What was that?
Floorboards.
The floorboards? Have they always sounded like that?
Uh-huh.
They talk to me often. Sometimes I think they're my only friends.
Oh, okay.
There's another loud noise.
See, there they go again. Quiet down, please. I'm spending time with my other friends now.
Weird, I never heard them before.
Well, now you have. What's up?
Are we going to have lunch?
Lunch.
You invited me over for lunch, Muriel?
Oh, poop. You're right, I did.
Yeah, poop, you did. Did you forget?
I must have. But I'm gonna have some more coffee. Would you like some?
No, thank you. It's really not my place to keep asking, but I can see something is up.
No, nothing. I'm good.
Okay. Well, hey, look, Rusty said something to me.
What? More empty promises?
Excuse me?
Huh? You were saying Rusty?
Yeah, Rusty said something to me about you, and I wanted to ask you about it.
Good. Because I want to ask you something, too.
Okay, you first.
No, you first. Please, I insist. No, you know what? Never mind. I'll go first.
Oh, okay.
When we had dinner the other night, you said that if you really thought about it, you could pinpoint the exact moment when things started going downhill with you and Rusty.
Oh, yeah.
When was it?
Oh, God, why were you thinking about that? Is everything okay?
Oh, I've been thinking a lot lately.
Okay.
And I figured if you were so good at knowing when Rusty lost interest, you could probably help me identify it, too.
In Tom?
In Tom, right, yes. Because I have no idea what to look for.
Wouldn't it be easy if there was an easy answer? It's strange, though. Rusty and I have actually been getting along lately.
Oh, really?
Sort of. In a way.
Wow. Isn't that great?
Not really. I just still feel...
What?
I don't know.
So, when did he lose interest?
Oh, right. Okay. Look, I need you to keep this between us.
Of course.
I think maybe Rusty feels at peace in a strange way with the broken nose, with all the gauze.
What do you mean?
I broke his dick. Years ago.
That is absolutely not what I expected you to say.
I did. Isn't that crazy? Did you know that could happen?
No.
We were having sex, wild, dirty, kinky sex, and I snapped his dick. There was this audible crack, and then it just sort of went limp. He screamed and threw me off of him. He ran into the bathroom. It literally snapped, Muriel. The doctors had to, like, operate on his urethra and patchwork it back together. It's healed now, but different. And he won't ever forget about it. That's exactly when things went crooked for us.
Is that why it curves like that? Huh?
What did you say?
Nothing.
Yes. Yes, you did. You, Muriel?
I just mean you've told me. You mentioned it before.
No, Muriel, I haven't. I have never told you that. Ever.
I'm sorry, Beck.
Excuse me?
I'm sorry. What else do you want me to say? Can I say more than that?
Are you kidding me? How did I not know? Holy shit! Muriel?
I didn't do it to hurt you, Rebecca. Please know that.
Oh, no? Then what?
Because
Yes, Muriel, we do.
Can we at least try?
Try to what? What should we try, Muriel?
I don't know what I was going to say, but I thought I should try and protest.
Yeah.
Beck, wait.
What could you possibly have to say to me?
I'm sorry that I've hurt you.
Huh. Don't think for one second that you've had any effect on me at all. Because you haven't. Eat shit and die, Muriel.
Lights shift. 22. Later. Rebecca is in the kitchen making a late lunch. Or attempting to. She drops a piece of silverware, realizing that she can't really hold anything. Making a sandwich is difficult with her hands wrapped up. She drops the silverware. She picks it up and attempts again, but drops the silverware again.
What are you doing?
Oh, shit. You scared me. Hey, Ty Bo, I need your help.
What are you doing?
What am I actually doing, or what am I attempting to do? Because I am attempting to make a late lunch.
Looks like a lavish lunch.
Yeah.
Are you okay?
Yeah, I'm great. I just need some help, you know, holding things. But otherwise, really great.
You seem great.
Yeah?
Yeah. I mean, it's hard to take you seriously when you look like you've been attacked, eaten, and devoured by medical gauze, but you seem pleasant.
Pleasant? I'll take pleasant, right?
Sure.
I just feel like so much weight has been lifted off my shoulders. I feel light. I'm good. I feel good.
Good.
Oh, what's with the gloves, babe?
Ty removes his gloves. His hands, too, are covered in bloody gauze.
Ouch, what happened?
It's fine, really. Occupational hazard.
Oh.
Been working really hard on a project.
Yeah, another statue?
Yes, kind of.
Awesome. I can't wait to see it. When you're done, maybe we can find something somewhere really great to put it, maybe the front yard.
Really?
Sure, yeah.
I think I'm almost done, actually. Well, I think it's almost done. I never really decide. The gargoyles usually decide on their own once they're released from the stone.
I think that's a really lovely thought.
Yeah?
Salvation through release, yeah.
Me too.
Maybe one day you can make a statue of me.
Yeah, maybe.
He helps her make the sandwich.
Is that all you want on this?
Yeah, I'm not hard to please.
He finishes making her sandwich. Rebecca begins to attempt to clean up. She drops shit. Ty picks it up.
You can just leave it out. I'm going to make one too.
Oh, okay.
That is, if you don't mind some company for lunch.
No, baby. Not at all. That'd be nice.
Ty makes himself a sandwich.
What about you? What happened to your hands?
Oh, just a little something. A quick procedure the doctor told me about.
On your hands.
Yeah, I wanted my fingers thinned. I didn't really care for the look of them. It's a simple shave down of the bone, a tightening of the skin. Bam! You're done.
Did it hurt?
Not at all.
Does it hurt now?
No, nothing really does.
Good.
I also had my palms smoothed out. I had too many lines, too much texture. But with a simple chemical peel to remove a layer of skin, a graft to introduce new, smoother skin to the palms, they'll be brand new in no time, just as soon as I heal. Also, I had my lips crafted some. They call it a pronounced Cupid's bow. They formed a little dip in my top lip. It's going to be really cute. Oh, especially with the grin lift I had them do, too. They cut the skin under my chin and pulled it up. And then they made these small incisions in the corner of my mouth so that I will have a more natural grin when my face is in a resting position.
Holy shit, Mom, that's a lot.
Yeah, but it's good.
Is it?
Mm-hmm. Yes. I'm going tomorrow to have the pitch of my voice altered. It's just a simple procedure.
Oh, yeah, a voice lift?
Yes. That's actually what it's called. The
doctor will inject collagen into the vocal fold so they'll plump up and become more limber. I'll sound younger.
Oh. When it's all finished, will you come see my...
Your gargoyle?
My statue.
Yes, honey, of course.
Dad saw it.
Did he?
Yes.
And what did he say?
He said it was beautiful.
Well, I bet it is, babe.
Lights shift. 23. Later that day, Muriel stands in her guest room turned drug lab. Shauna is asleep, passed out in the bed. Muriel watches Shauna sleep. Then Rusty's voice is heard somewhere off.
Muriel, hey, it's Rusty.
Shauna, wake up.
I'm sorry about the knocking earlier. I'm trying to be quiet.
Wake up. This isn't about the drugs. Candy.
Then can I please get a quick nap in? I'm exhausted.
Oh, not right now. Wake up. We have a visitor.
What? A visitor? Who?
Hey, Muriel. You home?
Shit. Dad. Hurry. Go to him before he comes up here.
Too late. He's coming up the stairs. Hurry. Get under the bed. Grab your things.
You want me to hide under the bed?
Yes. Hurry and be quiet this time.
Shauna hides her shit under the bed and slips under too. Rusty appears in the door.
Muriel.
Hey. Rusty. I'm sorry. I didn't hear you come in.
The front door was open. It's a good thing we live in a safe neighborhood.
What can I do for you?
What are you doing up here?
He sits on the bed. I'm cleaning the guest room, if you must know. Though that's none of your business. Can I help you?
Whoa. You're being pretty cold.
Well,
what? Okay, let's talk.
Let's not. We really shouldn't have any sort of talk right now, Rusty. Please, it really needs to wait. Can you get up? I have to make the bed.
Rusty gets up, moves toward the door.
Okay, look. I'm sorry for anything I may have put you through.
Everything's fine, dear. We can talk about this some other time. Come on, I'll show you out.
Muriel, don't do that.
We're not going to talk about this now, Rusty.
But yeah, we should, because I'm calling it quits. I'm done.
Rusty, please.
I had a great time with you, really.
Not now.
And I love that you aren't my wife, and I love that we don't have kids to deal with together, you know? Two people become a different sort of relative when they have kids. It's like I told you the other day. There's something so nice about leaving everything you have, you know, the life you were given behind, even for a few minutes or an hour or an afternoon or whatever, just to remember what it's like to not be yourself.
Stop.
You know? Don't be upset.
I need you to leave. I need you to leave now.
Yeah.
But Rusty, don't say shit like that. Shauna and Ty are great kids. They're wonderful, smart kids. They're beautiful. You shouldn't ever take that for granted.
I don't.
Good.
I just meant, you know, having a wife and kids fucking sucks sometimes.
Doesn't. You love them. You love Ty. You love Shauna very much, and you always will.
Yeah, I do. I love them a lot, and I always will. Which is why I'm working on my own shit and stopping all this with you. Once I figure out my shit, I can better help them with theirs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Bye, Rusty.
See you around, Muriel.
Shauna crawls out from under the bed. Light shift. 24, the next morning. Ty in the basement. He stands before his massive creation. It looks different than before, more intricate, more disturbing. The gargoyles, all four of them, are starting to merge as recognizable faces. Rebecca, Rusty, Ty, and Shauna. Recognizable, but distorted renderings of them. He's hard at work on it. The sounds of his work punctuate the scene.
Get your shit together, we gotta go. We're leaving.
What?
Let go, like pack our shit and flee.
Why?
Because someone has to, and it should be us before anyone else.
What are you talking about? Are you serious?
Someone leaves. Someone always leaves, and I'd rather it be the one to do it. I don't want to be the one who's left, and you should come with me. I'll watch after you.
Rusty appears in his office at work. He sits at his lavish desk, still in his contractor clothes. He has his guitar. He begins to strum a sound. He looks empty as shell.
Stop laughing like that, asshole! I'm being serious. I know information that you don't, and...
So you're running away?
If we go now, we'll be able to escape mostly unharmed.
You haven't been home these last few days, so you wouldn't know this. And I don't want to freak you out because you have already expressed some intense and confusing resistance to my...
Shut the fuck up about your statue, Ty! Don't you see what's going on?
Ty's pounding and Rusty's guitar begin to blend. The sounds bleed into each other, forming a new pulsing sort of trance sound.
Dad came downstairs and said my statue was beautiful. And then Mom and Dad sat outside the other day together and laughed. Not only did they laugh, but they sat together while Dad played his guitar, and they shared a joint. I smelled it through this basement window. It was nice, Sean. Mom and I made sandwiches together. It's working, Shauna. It's really working.
Shut up! Shut up about your stupid fucking statues. Shut up about your stupid fucking gargoyles. They're not doing shit. Don't you see that?
Whoa, Sean.
It's over. Everything is over, or it will be soon. I set it all up, my lab, my drug lab, Muriel's. It's there in her guest room, and before I left to come get you, I called the police and gave her up. We're all fucked, and there's nothing we're going to be able to do to stop it. Things aren't getting better for us or anyone. They're rotting, and soon they'll die. And we're just going to be stuck here, fucked up beyond all recognition because we didn't realize how to get out in time. It's all gone, Ty. But we can stop it if we leave now. I have money, a lot of money, for the both of us. If we leave now, we'll be okay.
No. I'm not going anywhere. I'm staying right here, and I'm going to finish this gargoyle. I'll get to that spot where the spirit is, and...
There are two types of people in this world, Ty. People who are given a life, and people who choose a life.
Shauna gets up, and with the rage of a wild animal or an angry beast, charges the massive statue. She collides with it, scratching, clawing, pushing, attempting to destroy it.
What the fuck are you doing? Stop!
Ty tries to stop her. They struggle. Shauna's anger makes her strong. Ty's need to protect his creation makes him strong. They fight. Shauna charges the statue with one final breath of intense anger and hurt, and Ty can't restrain her. The massive gargoyle wobbles and falls off its pedestal. The gargoyle shatters into a million pieces. The lights go out. There are sounds of wings, of breath. The pieces broken in the dark begin to glow. There's a hum, there's a static, there's breathing. Rusty stops playing his guitar, almost as if he heard the shattering of the gargoyle. Muriel appears, chain-smoking 1,000 cigarettes and crying. She too looks as if she heard the shattering of the gargoyle. Suddenly, she's bathed in the red and blue lights of the police cars coming to arrest her. Rebecca appears, even if we can't see her features due to being wrapped in so much gauze. She appears nonetheless, and it looks like she's smiling. Lights shift. 25. Later that night, it's dark. We see Rusty sitting. He has the old, once-loved guitar in his lap. Rebecca enters, covered in so much gauze we can't see her face. Her voice sounds slightly different.
Rusty, are you out here?
Hey, what happened to your voice?
I'm surprised you noticed. I had a voice lift. Isn't it nice?
Another surgery? Look, are you able to talk, or does it hurt?
Yes, I can talk fine. But that doesn't mean this won't hurt you. I know.
What do you know?
About you two?
Rebecca.
Shh. Don't.
Should I apologize? Because Rebecca listened to me, I really... want to apologize.
Rebecca begins to remove the gauze from her head. Some of her hair peeks out and falls down in large curls.
No, Rusty, you don't have to apologize.
But I want to.
No, you don't. You want to say, Rebecca, please don't leave me. That's what you really want to say. So say. Say. Or don't. I don't mind. Because I am. I am leaving you.
She begins to remove the gauze from her face. So
Some of her skin peeks out. It's beautiful. And I don't want you to resist because I know we'll both be happier without each other. Just because I'm a wife and a mother doesn't mean I'm a good one. And I don't want to be a part of it anymore, in this sense. I've had a miserable life with you. And now I've found something deep inside myself that I need to recognize. There is a wall in our bed, Rusty.
I started to take it down, Rebecca. I thought that we were starting to work on things. I thought that we were starting to connect again.
We were. You're right. But I was still so deeply unhappy with you. When it was bad, when it was good, it didn't matter. I was always deeply and constantly unhappy. She removes the totality of the gauze from her face. We see her now for the first time in a long time, uncovered. She's unrecognizable. A different actress stands before us. But it's Rebecca. A new Rebecca.
Holy shit. Rebecca.
Yes.
You look beautiful. Absolutely unlike yourself, but beautiful.
Good. Because I can't stay here with her, with that woman I was. I just wanted you to be fair and good to me, and that couldn't happen.
No, Beck, I am fair and good to the people who let me be fair and good to them.
Where are the kids?
You want to do this in front of them?
No, I do not. Which is why I asked where they were. You'll be a better father to them without me here. And when you all wake up tomorrow, you'll feel the sun on your face in a way that I hadn't for so long.
Cut it out, Rebecca. No tragic airs, please. That's what marriage is. Rebecca, wake up. Marriage isn't always sunshine. It's fucking hard, okay?
I'm going tonight. And you'll be free of any responsibility you have to me and I to you. Perfect freedom on both sides.
You know, some people would say that when you find yourself in a situation, no matter how much you don't like it, or no matter how much unhappiness it causes you, your job is to stay with it and work to fix it. Like an adult. Like a mature person.
And some people would say that you should preserve yourself before you preserve others. You will all be fine without me. Don't think that you won't.
Do you even consider the fact that you're my wife? That you're Ty and Shauna's mother?
I don't want to be yours. I don't want to be theirs. I want to be mine. Goodbye, Rusty. Tell Ty and Shauna that I love them.
Rebecca exits. Rusty remains. He looks at the stars. Sad. Lights shift. 26. Epilogue. Prague Park on the west side. It's a beautiful day in a beautiful park. Time has passed. We see a large statue. It's a gorgeous rendering of a woman in a calm, serene pose that very much resembles Rebecca before her physical transformation. Ty sits nearby on a park bench, looking up to it. He looks older. A woman enters. It's the woman we've been seeing, the woman that appeared in the shadows throughout. But now we see her in full force. It's Rebecca after her physical transformation. She stands watching the statue. Watching Ty. She goes over to the bench near him.
May I?
Of course.
She's something, isn't she?
Yeah, she's beautiful.
You think?
Yes.
They sit, watching the statue together. The former Rebecca enters. They don't see her. She, too, sits on the bench.
What brings you to the park today?
I just needed the fresh air.
Yes, me too.
They sit, all three, watching the statue together. New Rebecca pulls out a sandwich from her bag, begins to eat it.
Would you like the other half of my sandwich?
Oh, no, no thanks. You know, she was part of a larger piece.
Hmm?
The statue here, she was part of a larger piece, but...
But what?
I don't know.
They sit, watching the statue together. It's quiet. The former self, Rebecca, gets up. She looks at them, smiles. They still don't see her. She leaves. Sort of float, dances off. She disappears.
Longe du silence, je suis venu.
Longe du silence, juste suis venu.
Lights fade. End of play.
Of it and its and its presentation in a blooming way.
Good, thank you. What else?
What's on your mind right this second as you stew about this play?
Yes, sir.
The scenes between the characters having it seemed like the tide. Like a kid that's afraid of the water but wants to go to it.
Yeah.
So when the tide comes up, they're like, oh shit, I gotta go away. But as the tide goes, starts to fade back to like, oh wait, no, the water leaving, this is my opportunity. And it was back and forth like that. It went between all of the characters. Yeah.
Well,
thank
you for that. What else?
Okay. After the first half, we were talking about, I don't know where the hell we're going. And then somehow, we put it all together. It was amazing. It was amazing. I thought you guys were great.
Thank you.
What else?
I'm kind of like still stuck on the coffee part. maybe we have some.
That's a special confession.
Yeah, I was just I'm trying to think of a central theme that brought it together for me. It was about images realized and unrealized. You had the sculpture going on, you had the physical reconstruction going on, but there were other kinds of tensions between appearances and realities that were playing off of each other.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
To amplify the first comment, when I think about it, there really are far more than the legal number of complexities that should occur in two acts. And yet I think keeping the number of characters small and a allows us to sort through that with the characters without having to keep up with who is whom. Mm-hmm. I think there, if an audience not having seen how many characters from the beginning are going to be in the play would keep expecting other characters to enter and probably would get well into the first act or near the end of the first act before they realize there's nobody else.
Oh.
You know, it's all, this is it. And I think that limiting that number of characters really allows, and I would have thought otherwise. If I had not seen it play out, I would have thought otherwise.
Yeah.
That limiting the number of characters actually plays to the advantage of having so much complexity.
Thank you very much for that. What else?
Yeah. Well, it's interesting, the Doll's House parallels are many and obvious, but it seems that is almost just like a framework in which this play exists, because at its core, it doesn't seem to be about the same thing as Doll's House is. But I'm just now processing and about what the hell it is about.
Yeah.
That's still sort of like mulling around.
Yeah. Good. Thank you. Yeah.
So it's almost, I love film.
Yeah.
And I think about the movie Crash.
Yeah.
And right when we got to the end, that last part, lights are blinking, boom, 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 and everybody's on stage. I was ready to go.
Yeah.
Lights out.
Yeah.
And then it was like we took a breath, and in one sense, it was almost like the filmmaker couldn't decide which ending we wanted. So, oh, there's more.
Yeah.
So that's the one thing that kind of, I was ready for it to do. And then we took a breath and kept going, and then it stopped. And I kind of knew it was going to stop, but because it happened the first time, I thought, oh, maybe it's going to happen the second time.
Thank you. That's very interesting.
Yeah. It was a nice reprieve that the kids were at least rooting for each other and with each other when the parents are so selfish. And you very rarely get to, I don't think you often see parents that are portrayed that way. But really, I mean, looking out for themselves.
So yeah.
It was nice to see that balance.
So that was a plus for you?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm really interested in hearing some conversation about the relationships. I mean, what do we think about the sibling relationship and the parent-child relationship? What is there any quality about those relationships that you find particularly attractive or resonates in some kind of way for you or that you have a question about? What was interesting? What was compelling about any of these relationships? Do you find yourself right now kind of reflecting on any of that? Yeah.
I think it was sad. I think that the people, that each of them were unhappy with themselves, and they were searching for something. Even the boy was searching for some spirit to put in this sculpture that he was doing. I think they were all unhappy, and they were all just trying to change themselves or seek something besides themselves and not deal with what was real in themselves.
Yeah.
I guess I'm a little perplexed between the relationship between Rebecca and her kids, which is where I think that parallel to the Doll's House resonated much very strongly to me, because the criticism of that play is always like, well, okay, she discovers her independence, but she leaves her kids, and what are they going to do?
Right.
And I know, I guess the resolution here was that she just wasn't a good mother, and that wasn't her thing, and I guess it was saying she wasn't enough of, she had to figure out her own problems before she could help her kids, but I don't know, maybe I just need to suspend my disbelief a little bit more, and maybe this is just a cliche, that, well, of course mothers love their kids no matter what, you have to, but I wasn't just sure, I guess I'm not exactly sure what to think of that relationship.
Okay.
Am I supposed to just say, well, she's not a great mother and she's better off away from her kids, or, I mean, was there really nothing? Did she really never before give a card to her kids? I guess I'm not.
Yeah.
Sure, if I'm giving too much thought to that relationship.
Right, that's the question you have.
Yeah.
Well, what were you going to say?
Yeah, it did seem awfully abrupt, you know, in a way. Like, I'm leaving the kids, and really the only indication that she was a bad mom was the fact that, you know, they mentioned earlier in the play that you know, they'd never gotten a birthday card from her. And then that's when you realize the father had, you know, written her a message or whatever. But, I mean,
yeah.
Maybe that could be developed more to show that there's, you know, nothing going on with her and her children.
What do we think about the father's relationship with the kids? What do we have a sense?
He seemed like he related to them.
Seemed like he related to it? Anybody agree or disagree with that?
I liked him. I really liked how he encouraged his son. Loved that.
Is there any moment in the play, now that you've had a couple minutes since it was in the play, that you thought that are going to stick with you maybe? A particular moment or an exchange or a scene or an image that you think is, I'm going to remember that.
Yeah, the first time that like cut it out hit me, the memo of the play for me was between the mistress slash neighbor slash suburban meth head and the husband when she came to the office to talk about the affair,
yeah.
And Rusty said something to the effect of, well, sometimes shit just doesn't work out, you know, and she's got to cut it out. But he didn't say that, he didn't use those words, but that was the first time where I it was like the, you know, there were so many cascades after that where that was reaffirmed and that was shaped more. But the first one, I was like, oh, that is, that we that's the crack in the armor.
Cool. Thank you very much. Anybody else? Have a moment to send in.
There was the moment where the daughter, had gotten the birthday card, and it says, you look just like your mom, or you look more and more like your mother.
Right.
And then, of course, she's having that conversation with mom, and mm-hmm. she sees everything that she's doing to change that.
That'll stick with you for a while.
That is the most disturbing thing in the play, when the daughter realizes, mm-hmm. after being told she looked like her mom, that her mom didn't want to look that way.
Mm-hmm.
So now her mother is deliberately going away from her.
So that landed on you. Yeah, what were you
going to that reminded me of the episode of Cheers, though. Do
you
remember that? The daughter was awkward and not pretty, and she was visiting her father who worked for the bar, and he says, but you look just like your mother. And she says, but mother was beautiful. And he says, I know, you look just like her. So there's that love and passion for this person that sees this person as loving. And that 5 years ago,
Thank you. Yeah.
I really like when Todd said, and they're looking at the statue, and said it used to be part of a larger piece.
Mm-hmm.
That was really neat.
Mm-hmm.
Cool.
That whole moment of him being there with his mom, who's finally happy but a different person entirely, there's just so much, I don't know, there's so much in there to like unpack, but like at the same time, it's like frightening and kind of powerful and somehow serene for both of them.
Yeah.
In a really cool couple.
Serene enough for the old Rebecca to leave it.
Yeah.
And smile when she does.
Yeah.
Which I think, ultimately I think that says something about the relationship she has with her kids. It doesn't seem to me to be like underdeveloped, right? She's really not connecting with them.
Yeah.
There's a lot of connectivity.
She's not connected with anything.
You see the twins very connected. You see the dad really trying. I mean, like, he's out of sorts a little bit. He doesn't look right in that apron that he's wearing, and that he's having a hard time parenting. He's attempting at it. She's beyond attempting at it because she doesn't even know her.
Yeah.
So the information I put on getting at the end of the play is, now that she knows herself, she probably could have a relationship with him, but like you described, we're not doing that, right? Like, we've kind of come to a place where like, everything's fine, time to go.
Right.
It's such an unusual place for it to go, like just in the normal world, if you're a mother or for, just TV viewing or movie viewing where the ending just has to be a certain way. The fact that she gets herself all squared up, squared away and kind of healthy, and it has really nothing to do with wanting to be a parent to her.
I think it's hard for us to accept culturally, right?
Yes.
It's an exciting question.
Yeah, just because
so
you have the kids doesn't necessarily mean it's going to be a great parent.
Yeah, I'd love.
Muriel says that too.
They
never wanted kids.
What was?
My favorite line, it's like the one moment where it was like an awkward, unsettling piece that I felt when she said, I may be a mother and I may be a wife, but I'm not good. Like, I'm not good at either one. I can't remember. It was when you guys were sitting there talking, and like, you're just that resting smile, whatever it was supposed to be happening.
Right?
I saw it, and I was just like, I felt that unsettling piece as a woman. I was like, okay, you do your thing, girlfriend.
I
don't know. It's weird, but I'm like not comfortable with it, but I'm okay with it.
I think it's fascinating. One of the things we've talked about is like gender roles in the family, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so I agree that it's very culturally hard to accept a woman leading her children.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And not to get too personal or anything, my brother is a single father because his child's mother left them. So this is a very real piece. I mean, this is, it's hard to accept, and it should be. It's a horrible thing for anybody to leave their kids, but it happens.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And so to me, it doesn't seem, and the fact that it is abrupt is very powerful to me, because of course you don't ever see somebody leaving coming. I mean, maybe you do sometimes, but a lot of the times it's just like, bam, done. You know?
I think there's also a different perception as to the mother leaving and the father.
Mm-hmm. Right. Gender roles,
yeah.
That helps.
Maybe this is my failing, but the thing that I'm having the most problem with, you know, and this is the image that stays with me, is the brick wall in the bed. It works as a metaphor, obviously, you know, but as something real, it's so surreal that I found myself sort of losing track of the story because I kept going into my head and thinking, well, how would that actually work? You know, number one, you know, where she would get into bed and not notice it, you know, so that she could break her nose on it, you know, and how could you actually build, you know, so I kind of lost some dialogue and parts of the story because I'm like trying to work this out in engineering in my head.
Okay, good, thank you.
I have a question to respond to that question, and that's, can you actually break your dick?
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Really? Oh, yeah. Which is in my head. And, well, that's great news to know. What I really like about that is like there's this like super awesome drug that you can just make out of a duffel bag.
Yeah.
You can put a brick wall in a bed, and you can break your dick, which were three things I thought you couldn't do.
Well, you can shave your fingers.
Yeah. But so there's this like sort of surreal thing, and it's like I really applaud the story being so compelling. I don't really need to exist in the world anymore. I can be a little surreal and screw it. It's not gonna exactly check out all the time. But I was totally moved along with that. Like, even though I knew that this metaphor was weird and that there's probably no drug you can do that, and you probably can't get your pumps smooth. It didn't bug me because the way the story took me there. Like, this is surreal and I'm down.
Yeah. Well, I believe all of these surgical procedures described are actually surreal.
Oh my God, that's just one front. Now I only have the brick
wall. You learned something new tonight.
Peter,
thank you so much.
Yeah.
Watch out for your dick.
Nobody's actually commented about the surgery, so Rebecca's attraction to them. How did that land on you?
I kept one thing that we didn't see in the reading. I can't wait till Steve sees the stage production. Is you've got to think, you're having an argument here. When she comes in wrapped in gauze, you're having an argument with the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man.
Right.
That's what you're going to see.
Right. So that's
the serious argument, and yet she's there wrapped in gauze. And
that image is very big.
Unless you staged it like this, you know, with, you know, which could take care of something, you know, then you wouldn't have to see, you know, the brick wall, you know, in the bed. You know, how would you stage that, you know? Doing it something like this, maybe a little bit more, whatever, would sort of remove the literalness, you know.
Yeah, I mean, these
and
are the
like
kind of questions that would have
bed,
to be asked.
For example, the bed
right?
would
yeah.
really distract people.
Yeah. I saw a hand over here. Yeah.
Oh, I thought it was really, I had expected it to end up where she was starting to look like one of his gargoyle sculptures, you know. I kind of expected the gauze to come off and it'd be almost like the Joker from Batman where she has this gargoyle-esque face.
Right.
So it was really interesting that she had become beautiful, I guess, in her, like you said.
Right.
And then I also found it interesting that as he was starting to come around to her and maybe want to reconnect, saying that he liked her eyes, don't change them, and she was changing the things that he was saying he liked about
right.
her.
Thank you for that. Yeah. Is anybody else? Yeah.
I thought it was really interesting that each had definitely identity crisis going on, but the one who went internal as opposed to external, the one internal was the son. He went into to bring out the beauty of it, where the other ones took things, the
the drug, making the drug, this and that, you know, and so I thought that was really interesting. That the son, to me, was probably the most healthiest person here.
Yeah.
On this thing. Mm.
I completely agree with that. If we're gonna like the message though, that like this is kind of sort of asking us to question and even approve of a mother leaving her kids. So the son is making like really horrific, you know, challenging art, right? And then when something really terrifying and another terrifying, awful thing happens to him, he makes a beautiful statue. I know you shouldn't draw that correlation. That's not the right way to look at theater, or like look at some. Well, it's not the right way to be like these are related necessarily, but like it's funny to say like, well, this awful thing happened, and he made something socially acceptable enough to be in a park.
Yeah.
You know.
Interesting.
Kind of a production question, which I'm sure has to have been discussed. Having experienced playwrights and screenwriters who sometimes imagine things that are either impossible or expensive to create, what have y'all talked about regarding the mechanics of how her character will transform physically? I mean, would she start off? I mean, there is so much emphasis placed on the difference in her beginning to end that it almost seems like more than an actor could do with just physicality.
It's a totally new actor.
So it had to be two women that are the same.
So really,
basically.
Okay.
Yeah. But. Yeah, different
so
people.
So what point does the transition occur?
When she leaves, when she takes her business off, it's a different person.
Yeah.
So when she comes in
the
to leave,
and she's all wrapped
she'd
up
be a different
voice,
actor.
Yeah.
But she was there from the beginning, too. She was the shadow woman.
Right.
She was
Right. So it's actually described in the page that kind of from the voiceless moment forward when she's completely suave, that you actually have to trade out an actress and have a completely different person revealed when the dolls happen. And then, of course, and then the other thing that's on the page is you get to see both of them together at the end, Rebecca couldn't figure out a way to split it.
I wanted to. I'm all for it.
The snappy stage directions get a shout out.
Yeah.
All right, thank you. I am actually going to invite Andrew to come up on stage and join us.
Yeah, so overarching in my life, like, I have issues with, like, domesticity, and, like, I have issues with, like, considering and pondering, like, roles, not only, like, gender roles, but also, like, familial roles and lover roles and sibling roles and all those things. Like, I feel like we put so much pressure on all of that, and so that I was considering that, and then I had heard the sentiment of a mother or a woman should love her husband more than her children for a marriage to work. And I was like, that's sort of problematic to me. And then I started thinking about the bait and switch, right? I was like, I wonder if it is a possible in a world in which we can have an actress and know her for about 2 hours, and then at the last moment, reveal as a different actress, same character. What would happen, right? We still don't know if it'll work. That's sort of the things that led me down the path.
Yeah, cool.
Soap operas have done it for years.
Fair point.
Susan looks you good.
What do you want to know about?
Yeah, did you make it, obviously the mother, it was never enough. It was always going further and further. I mean, thinner fingers, I think. But the daughter, she had a plan. Yeah. She was going to do this, and she had a stop date of all of them, and she stuck to it. I mean, why did she have that? Why was she unlike the other three?
I'm drawn into even though socially and culturally and in action maybe what she's doing is really harmful or negative. I was interested in her having like that sense of stability. So she's really good at what she's doing. What she's doing is terrible, but she's really good at it. And so I was interested in how can that be dismantled enough for her to like kind of switch. I wanted to see Shauna really hurt, and I wanted to see her sad. And I thought about her hearing information from her father So that's where that scene where she's under the bed came from. I think that she's hurt in that scene.
She definitely is, but yeah. I thought whether she heard that or not, I thought she really was going to quit. Where in reality, whoever quits when it's going that good, I don't think they quit.
Fair point.
How many people, like, of these five people, who like, almost died the most? Like, were there versions of your writing, like, they, you know, like in my head, I thought, they're going to get killed by the statue because it didn't have grounding, you know, sure. But you didn't kill them.
I did, too, when we were reading it. That was totally. For the first time I went,
like,
okay.
So you're deep in it, like, who was going to die the most?
You know, I think every single other play that I've ever written, someone dies in. And I think I was never interested in that with this piece. Right, I think one of the questions that I think the play asks, or I intend to ask at some point, is like an end that we don't know. Yeah. Right, like leaving or disappearing without death yet. And so I didn't want to kill any of them on stage, or even off stage. So none of them ever died.
I'm
going to
die.
Yeah, I mean, you're
going to
die in prison.
Yeah. That's she's low.
But I think that there are possibilities for all of them to die in, like, the later story.
Okay.
Yeah.
But your original mother died. She died.
Right. She, like, is gone. Yeah.
Oh, that's fascinating.
That's
interesting.
Did you have a question?
Actually, Jeremy Sony.
Oh, awesome.
Oh, so that bit of French. I was actually reading, so weird, because I'm not sure that it really comes across in the play. I was actually reading Victor Hugo's writing, Hunchback of Notre Dame, and he was fond of this phrase. And he would say that he would look at the cathedrals, and he would look at statues, and he would look at gargoyles, and he wouldn't be able to talk, which I thought was cool.
Very cool.
And that's sort of where it came from. So I had my brother translate that. What does this mean? And then they told me, and I was like, oh, that's awesome.
One of them had a line that I just love. Think it's about the father. He said it has his skin falls
rested on his face. Rested on his face. Yeah. That was talking about.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. That's a good question. That's tough. I think this play was hard for me to write because Doug and I were talking about it when he was in town mentoring. He was like, I don't know who you are in this play, right? Like, I don't really know. Now that I know you and I know the play, who are you in this play? And I was like, you're right. You know, like, I don't know. I think Ty maybe has some similarities and some honesty, like personal honesty maybe in him. I had fun writing them, though, but I don't know who was the easiest. They were all pretty hard in some ways.
Can you say what made them hard?
Yeah, so, like, I'm not, as a writer, I'm usually interested in, like, heightened language and, like, kind of, like, chamber, like convention, right, in plays of, like, non-realistic setting and time and place, but still kind of emotionally honest. And this play is, like, real in a way. Like, you know, it's domestic. And there are limitations that go with that in some ways. So I found that to be hard. And I also, I mean, it's really hard to, like, write a quote-unquote bad mom. Or, like, knowing. There was never a version of this play where Rebecca stays. She always left. And so, like, getting to that was, I had to figure that out, you know?
Why? Yeah.
The dialogue was great. The dialogue is boom, 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 boom. And it's like you walk into a room, and you're in the middle of this fourth wall, and you're just watching yourself.
Cool, thank you. Thank you.
He's incredibly talented. We would come back a day later, 2 days later, whatever, and there's, you know, two scenes on the table that haven't even been, and something's major shifted, you know. I mean, it's
that was just because I was like, oh shit, people are going to see this. I was like, oh, there are going to be audiences in 3 days.
As a matter of fact, at the first play reading, the final scene between Rusty and the scene where, you know, she's under the bed, never been read.
Never.
Yeah.
We ran out of time in the blocking and everything and the editing and all that kind of stuff that Martha looked at us and said, well, it's an adventure.
I do want to say, though, to that
awesome.
End, I think that's what's so amazing about this and has been amazing for me, especially with these actors and director and fellow writers, is that, like, they will not let you get away with anything, which is awesome, right? If you're, like, having these really smart, astute, talented, impulsive actors being like, but wait, like, I can't do that. I don't know why I'm doing that. Like, we would have these conversations about, like, three lines, right, that would change the entire play in some ways. And, I mean, that's just great. Y'all have a cool city here.
Yay. Yes, sir.
I have a question about your thoughts about the physicality of the statues, in that when you're putting on a play that one of the characters is an artist, you're limited to the skills of your set designer to how the statues, in this case the gargoyles and the intertwined gargoyles, are going to look. Did you have a thought, or was there a description, and maybe I missed it, about how good the art was, how expressive was it, how would that be expressed in a staging of the play, and also what were your ideas about how the statue that is eventually destroyed, is that done night in, night out on a fully realized play?
Sure. So I think that the second part is easier, right? So, like, I think that there is a way to do this play where there is this, like, probably styrofoam, right, like to paint it to look like stone, statue that Shauna may charge and the lights go out and you hear a crack, like, because the moment that follows that is fairly surreal, right? Like, we hear a gargoyle and it glows and things like that. So the shattering is, like, I'm not really worried about. I do have questions about, like, is Ty's work good? And, like, what will that
what
look like?
Good,
yeah, right. But I think the cool thing is that's kind of, it could look like anything. Because so much about the play is like, oh, I see a rock, I see a statue, I see horrendous surgery, I see a beautiful woman. I think it can maybe look like anything. And just the way they talk about it matters.
And there's so many of them in the garden.
Yeah.
Where the father is sitting, and then he has those in his studio. And you've got opportunities to do various stages of as he's honing his talent.
Correct.
Too.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's
totally
what I would think when I read this,
mm-hmm.
this multimedia stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But.
The synopsis says his family looks perfect from the outside, and they're clearly not to us. And so my question is that important to you, that's communicated, that they look perfect from the outside, because that was in the synopsis?
I think, like, if you saw a photo of them,
mm-hmm.
like the daughter resembling the mother, the dad being, like, right, like,
they're
and
wealthy.
Yeah, like, they kind of resemble, like, mom, dad, son, daughter, frame it, they're beautiful.
Mm-hmm.
But then, you know, when the play starts,
yeah.
Right, yeah, yeah. I think that, like, in some ways, that's, like, an ideal, right? Mom, dad, son, daughter.
Mm-hmm.
Right, totally. And they're wealthy.
And they have a decent successful. Amount of money.
Yeah.
And a great next-door neighbor.
well, thank you, honey.
Yeah, I was uninterested in starting the play off with, like, establishing their perfection.
Mm-hmm.
Right. I was like, I'm going to screw them up right from the start.
Yeah. I got that.
Yeah.
Can you? What? Yay!
Yeah.